Texas Red Flash is being brought to you by Time Warner Cable of Johnstown, Stagger Chevrolet of Crescent, and Haas's Steak and Sea House. And now to the Pine Bowl. Here's Charlie Weston and Craig Boslow.
And you are looking at the Pine Bowl. It's St. Francis College and the Duquesne Dukes. Charlie Weston here with Craig Boslow. Should be a pretty good game here. The last two have been between these two teams, boss.
This is small college football at its finest. A lot of these players play against each other in high school. And I know the coaches, Coach Gattuso and Coach Mayock, recruit similar kids from the same area. So it should be a fine football game.
Yeah, and you look at some of the kids on each side of the ball today, and you're going to see former teammates playing against each other. A lot of WPIAL influence in this game today, and of course some Central Pennsylvania influence too. There's a couple of local kids in there with Bellwood, Sean Ross, and Don Patty may get some playing time today from Bishop Guilfoyle. Should be a good one.
This is interesting football, Charlie, because you don't have a ton of people in the stands. The kids aren't getting scholarship money. They're playing the game because they love to play the game, and that's nice to see. It adds a whole new dimension to watching a football game.
Earlier today, we talked with Coach Pete Mayock, who was put into this head coaching position a little late. Frank Pergolese stepped down earlier, and we talked with Coach Mayock about the adjustments that he's had to make early on in this season.
Coach, you sort of got a late call to duty this year with Frank Pergolese stepping down at a late moment. How's it been? How's the transition gone for you?
Well, it's probably been an easier transition just because I've been here for 5 years. If I were walking into a brand new program in the month of June, we'd probably still be way behind right now. But I think just because I know all the players and know the system and the way things work around here, it's been a lot easier.
Is there a mark you want to put on this team or a mark that you have put on this team at this point?
Well, we turned the ball over a lot last week, so I guess that's my mark so far. No, I mean, obviously there's a mark I'd like to put on the team. I think, you know, we've been a pretty successful team the last few years, but then we fell off the last year or two. And I'd like to see us get back to our winning ways and be able to establish some consistency with the winning around here. And I think if there's any mark I can put on the program, that's what I'd like it to be.
Seemed like the hitting was good last week, some really good aspects of the game. Maybe a problem holding on to the football a little bit, but there were some positives.
I think we're a tough physical football team, and we certainly tried to make ourselves that during preseason camp. And last week we just got ourselves in a position where a quarterback made a couple bad decisions. And that really probably is my fault, just because we didn't put him in enough pressure situations in preseason camp. And so I think that was a little bit new to him last Saturday. And hopefully we fixed that problem for today.
Let's take a look down the schedule. Would you compare this? It seems that for somebody that's in this area, St. Francis football has tried to get better, tried to get more challenged over the last few years. Would you say this schedule meets that?
Yeah, with moving to 1AA, our schedule's just gotten tougher and tougher to the point where we're in a conference now where we don't have as much say over our scheduling. And, you know, you look at a school like Towson State being on our schedule this year, and it's getting tougher and tougher each year. And it puts a little more pressure on us to go out and keep recruiting good kids so we can continue to compete.
How much of an edge for you that you played and they didn't?
I hope that's a big edge, to be honest with you. I know most people say that the most improvement you make in a season is between the first game and the second game, and if that's the case, then hopefully Duquesne will still be making some first-game mistakes, and we'll be over that hump and be playing a lot better football than we played last week.
Well, there's a Seton LaSalle stamp all over this game. My goodness, Greg Gattuso, Penn State grad, coached at Seton LaSalle. Your quarterback was under him at that school, so what Seton LaSalle has provided today, probably you couldn't do without that school.
Right. It's an interesting matchup today because most of our players were recruited by Duquesne and most of their players were recruited by us. So all of our players know each other. We know, you know, as coaches, we know most of their players, and it makes for a real good rivalry.
Well, the last 2 years, you couldn't ask for much more. Last year was a low-scoring game, 7-3, and the year before that, they came from way back to beat St. Francis. So they've been on the winning end the last couple of years, but they've been good games.
All right. I think 2 years ago, it was a high-scoring game, and that game was played late in the season, and I think that's part of the reason for a lot of scoring. Last season, it was our second game, their first game, and there were a lot of those early season mistakes. Both teams having some trouble scoring, which is typical early in the season. So I think that's the reason for, you know, the contrast. But they were both great games, And to be honest with you, I don't see any reason why today's won't be a great game also.
That's a great setting up here in the Pine Bowl. I know we heard some of the Duquesne kids, they came onto the field earlier today just testing out the facility here, talking about they couldn't imagine there being a football field right in the middle of the woods here, but that's pretty much what it is at St. Grant.
Well, this is a beautiful setting for college football. You look around you and there's pine trees all up on the hills, and, you know, it's certainly not a football stadium yet, but, you know, it's really a beautiful sight for college football.
Well, we hope to have a beautiful game for it, too, today. Coach, good luck in today's game.
Thanks a lot, Charlie. Appreciate it.
Our national anthem on the St. Francis College Sports Network.
Welcome back as we get a shot of the stands here at the Pine Bowl in St. Francis College in Loretto, Pennsylvania.
Well, if you just walk through the woods here and you come across the football field, it is a different feeling. You know, you don't run into the huge traffic jams everywhere. It's obviously not going to be as well attended as your Penn States and Ohio States and that kind of thing, but it's a real family atmosphere up here, and it's just, you can feel it. It's a step above what you're used to on Friday nights. It's a nice thing. And these teams now playing a 1AA, but it's a little bit different, isn't it?
Right. The 1AA non-scholarship league has been formed within the last 2 years for those schools who have Division I basketball program, but are smaller schools as far as population is considered. The schools like St. Francis, Duquesne, Marist, some of those schools who traditionally have been known for their basketball, Charlie, now have been put into a league of non-scholarship 1AA versus the traditional 1AA where they're allowed to provide full scholarships. So as we mentioned before, these young men are playing without any scholarship money. They can get grant, financial aid, but as far as straight scholarship reimbursement for tuition, they can't get it.
And the quality here is really good. I mean, we're talking about teams that get together and hit and really play the game. We'll be back with the game, Duquesne and St. Francis, on the St. Francis College Sports Network after this message.
You and the heart in hospitality.
To thank our loyal guests.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You get a free Haas glass when you buy Haas's Your Way entree.
Pick your two favorites.
There's juicy steak, tender chicken filet, or choose from Haas's seafood menu. Entree includes Haas's fresh salad bar. You get it all.
And a free Haas glass.
For just $11.99.
Now that's hospitality.
Thank you.
Now, last week's game, a tough one to Gannon University, a loss 29-14. Game was very close throughout the first half, Buzz, and both teams traded field goals until a late touchdown from Gannon set them up to do the distance in the second half. And it was a game that was turnover-filled for St. Francis. But the big deal is that they played. Duquesne did not.
Right, and a lot of coaches use that first game to work out preseason jitters, a lot of mistakes. St. Francis has that first game under their belt. Statistically, they were pretty close to Gannon. They did have the big turnovers, the four INTs, which made the differential in the score. Duquesne, on the other hand, coming in, this is their first ball game. If you take a look at the coin toss.
A co-captain's on the field. Probably something of a reunion for some of them because they've all met before. One way or another, the Duquesne Dukes and St. Francis Red Flash. They played on the same fields over in the Pittsburgh area. Basically, Western Pennsylvania teams. Coin toss being explained to the Dukes as they'll get to call the flip.
And St. Francis wins the toss. Looks like they may have deferred. St. Francis will go to the left and move from left to right here in the first half. They did win it and will receive.
Getting back to the players playing against each other, Coach Gattuso, a former Penn Stater who is coaching Duquesne now, has actually coached St. Francis quarterback Joseph Rampt in high school at Seton LaSalle. And I think Tommy Flynn, who is another assistant coach, would be the offensive coordinator at Duquesne, former Pitt player, Green Bay Packers star, coached Rampt in high school as well. So not only have these players played against each other, we've actually had coaches, the opposing team, coach these kids in high school. So that adds a different flavor to a ball game.
I'm sure Pete Mack hopes they did a very good job in bringing along Joe Rampt at Seton LaSalle. And, of course, when we get to the play from scrimmage, we'll go through the starting lineup. St. Francis in, obviously, the red. And Duquesne in their road white with blue pants and red helmets. We're just about ready to go. St. Francis will receive. Jarvis Bell, number 7, goes back to his own 10-yard line. Mike Lesage, the other returner on the right hash mark. And kicking off for Duquesne will be number 3, Chris Bergman from Peters Township. We saw a kick last night at Mansion Park in Altoona, 53 yards to win a football game. I asked Frank Pergolesi if he thought that could be done here today, and he said, well, you never know. I guess that's true. Kickers are capable of anything. So Bell and Lesage are back deep, and Bergman still trying to get the tee to sit the right way for him.
So you think of the Duquesne players, Charlie, they've been practicing against each other for several weeks now, probably a month or better, without having the opportunity to hit someone from an opposing team, because you can't really scrimmage in college or it counts as a regular season ball game.
All right, Bergman hits it down the left hash. Lesage comes under. The reverse fake, and Lesage will take it. He's got running room. He's up to the 30. Lesage hit and dropped at the 40-yard line. A nice tackle in the open field from Mauro Mons for Duquesne, but a great return to the 40-yard line.
Mauro Mons makes a nice technique tackle there as he puts his face mask right into the shoulder pads, lifts and drops. So good contact to start the football game as a red flash. Take over first and 10 at their own 40-yard line.
Let's go to the starting offense for St. Francis. Quarterback is Joe Rampt from Seton LaSalle. He'll be number 11. There you see the offensive front with Sam Campoli. Flanking to the right side. Rampt looking to throw with some time. Rolls into pressure and throws short of his intended receiver at the 45-yard line. That was Sam Campoli. He ran right into the pressure that time.
That time they go to a naked boot. They're going to try to get the quarterback ramp out of the pocket. Good outside pressure by Mark Rayo as he's able to force the early throw and it threw the whole timing of the playoff.
It's second down 10 for St. Francis. And Campoli splits wide to the right side with Elliott Miller, former State College wide receiver, in the slot to the right and a wide out to the left. Ramp gives to the fullback, Sean Ross. Ross gets across the 45 and out to the 47-yard line. As Joe Neckerman makes the tackle, one of the linebackers for Duquesne. Those linebackers are Joe Neckerman, number 97 from Seton LaSalle, Christian Kesey, number 9 from York Catholic, and Matt Fisher from Shadyside Academy. He's number 46. Fisher a freshman, Kesey a junior, Neckerman a senior. And it's third down and about 3 for the red flash. Wide out left, flanker to the right side, out of the eye. The fake to Ross. Ramp keeps, won't get the first down. He'll come up short of it, and it'll bring up fourth and about 1 at the 49-yard line.
So we've seen a variety of offensive sets by St. Francis thus far. They've come out in a pro eye. That time they go to an eye slot. They're going to run the option, belly option, outside option. Pretty good defensive play there as the quarterback Rampt has to tuck it, try to get upfield. And he's going to be about a yard short. It's going to bring up a punting situation.
Fourth down 1, and back to punt is Matt Shontofsky, former Bishop McCourt kicker. Back deep for the Dukes is Bryan Cornell from West Allegheny High School, a sophomore, back at his own 15. It's a good kick. Drives Cornell back to the 2-yard line. Reverses field, gets away from one tackle. Cornell still alive, but he'll be brought down at the 15-yard line. He did a great job getting that punt out of the back to the end zone territory.
And most of the time, you're going to see a receiver let that go into the end zone for field position purposes. So I'm sure Coach Gattuso is going to have a word with that young man. You know, he made a decent return out of it. He's able to get out to the 15, but you know, when the punt goes to the 2-yard line, it's going to go into the end zone.
It backed him up a good bit too, boss, because he started out at the 15-yard line and just kept backing and backing and backing. Before he knew it, it was almost in the end zone. Ryan Staines will start at quarterback, 6'3", 210-pound senior from Father Geibel. They'll use both of their quarterbacks, Dave Loya the other one, and they go with a single setback. Staines hands the ball to Bill Green, the tailback. Green gets very little over the right side of the line, trying to sweep, 5'9", 185-pound senior from Northgate, and John Camello, cornerback for St. Francis, makes the tackle.
Coach Gattuso said he's got two quarterbacks that could play. They were pretty close coming into the season. He said he's going to start the senior, give him the chance, see how he's going to do it. He's got the sophomore in the wings that's ready to play if he needs to have him play.
We'll give you the Duquesne Dukes offensive lineup next as soon as this play is over. It's second down, 9. They go to the eye. Tim Gribble, the fullback. They break the eye, put Bill Green off to the right. Receivers either way. Staines looking through the middle. He'll try to get it to his tight end, does. Todd Sheenar of North Allegheny. That's a first down or close to it. Yeah, that'll be enough for the first down. Colin Snyder makes the hit for St. Francis. Good possession ball there out to the 30, or rather the 28-yard line.
That time they break the eye, go to a split back set, which normally is a passing set. Straight drop back. Quarterback buys himself some time, is able to complete the short hook to the tight end for first down yardage.
Let's look at that Duquesne Dukes offensive starting lineup. As coming out to the left side is Mark Neely. Boy, he's a big kid for wide receiver. Wide out to the right side as well, and out of the eye. Staines, the handoff to Green, gets a block from his fullback. Green across the 30, out to the 32-yard line, and a pickup of about 4. Kristen Kosminski makes the tackle for St. Francis.
That time Duquesne attacks the outside corner, that even front four-man, 4-4 defense being run by St. Francis. Duquesne's going to be running out of mostly a pro-eye this afternoon. That time they run with the off-tackle play. He's able to get to the corner and pick up 4 yards and bring up second and about 6.
Out of the eye, receivers either way. They break the eye, put the fullback Gribble to the right of quarterback Bryan Staines. Staines, the handoff to Green, he'll cut back. Gets across the 35 and out to the 38-yard line. Looks like it may be enough for a first down. Colin Snyder, the tackle for St. Francis.
That's a re-dive as Green's going to take the ball deep in the backfield. He has the option to either take it to the outside or cut it back inside, depending on what the defensive interior does. That time he sees daylight to the inside, and he's able to get upfield for a first down.
11 minutes left in the first quarter. We are scoreless at the Pine Bowl, St. Francis College in Loretto, Pennsylvania. And they work out of the eye. Receiver to the left side, Joe Rosato, another Seton LaSalle player. He is a sophomore. And a wide out to the right side as well. And a handoff to Green. The middle opens up. And Green takes advantage up to the 49-yard line. Kosminski makes the tackle again for St. Francis, but that's enough for another Duquesne Duke first down.
That's a good job by the Duquesne offensive line there as they go to a lead dive or a variation off the lead draws. They're going to lead the fullback up inside. He really has no one to block at the initial surge, but he's able to get to the linebacker. Green's able to get upfield for daylight, pick up another first down as Duquesne's on the move.
There you saw the rest of the Duquesne starting offense. Part of the starting offense was not Mark Neely, the wide receiver that comes over to the left side, but he is indeed in the game. Oh, yes, he was. He was a flanker, and that's what he is. So that's it. Again, the split in the eye. Staines gives the ball to Bill Green. Bill Green met at the side of the line by Greg Girdley, 6'2", 260-pound junior from Central Cambria. No gain on the play. It'll be second down, maybe a loss on the play of a yard. Second down at 11.
Coach Gattuso told me that he doesn't do anything fancy. He runs basic offense, pretty much stays in that pro-eye. He'll shift to a power back set or a split back set run some play action, pass off of it, uses his fullback to block a lot, likes to get the ball to his tailback Green, which they've done so far.
Again, receivers either side, split backfield. Bryan Staines, the quarterback, looks through the middle. It's blocked at the line of scrimmage. Incomplete. Third down, 11 coming up. Colin Snyder got his hands up in the air and knocked that one down. Snyder, the linebacker on the left side, 6'4", 220-pound sophomore from Greensburg, Salem.
And he's been active so far. We've called his name three or four times. That's just a timing play on his part. Obviously, he was coming on some form of blitz, whether he's locked on the halfback or not, but his timing was perfect. He's able to leap, knock the pass down, and Duquesne had receivers open had he not knocked that ball down.
Third down and 11. Straight eye in the backfield. Tight end left. Staines deep in the pocket. Firing it out toward the left side. Nice catch by Neely, but he was out of bounds. Or is he? No, they're going to give him the catch. You only need 1 foot down, and let's see what they're doing with it here. Is he giving him the catch?
They're going to call that an incomplete pass. Good effort by Neely there. Reigns forces the ball. He's not afraid to throw the ball. Let's watch this on replay. It's going to be a straight drop. You got three receivers in the route. Reigns going to look downfield. Neely goes up. Oh, just can't. We can't get a shot at the sideline there, but nice catch regardless. But he forced that into double coverage, which may be a factor as Reigns is able to strong arm that ball in there.
Was it just me or was the official marking the ball down there? I thought he was when he first started anyway. Now back to punt now. Bruce Nelson from Franklin Regional. He is a junior back at his own 33-yard line. And Lesage is back deep for St. Francis. Short kick, Lesage for a fair catch, has to run up under, gets it at the 23-yard line, and that's where St. Francis will begin on the 30-yard punt from Bruce Nelson. It is the first quarter of today's play. There is no score. We want to thank our sponsors for today's game and for the St. Francis College Sports Network, of course, including St. Francis College, Haas's Steak and Sea House, Steger Chevrolet, Crescent and Portage, and Time Warner Cable to Johnstown. And remember, next week, St. Francis and the Marist Red Foxes. Ramp turns, hands the ball to the tailback. That's Bryan Pittman coming up through the middle. Pittman from Gateway, 5'10", 185-pound freshman. Now let's look at that Duquesne-Duke defense as they come out in the 43 look. There is another linebacker. That would be on page two, I imagine. That was Wojciechowski, for those of you who are wondering about the top line pronunciation. It's a gain of four. Second and six for St. Francis. Two receivers left side. Ramp in pressure. Throws it too long. Nearly intercepted. On the far side of the field, it was Bryan Cornell, who got his hands on it but couldn't come down with the ball.
We see Duquesne go into a defensive adjustment already into the ball game, Charlie. They start off in an even four-man front, 4-3 look. Now they go to a 5-2, which gives them a little bit of strength at the end with the outside linebackers four deep. That time, St. Francis tries to throw into the strength. Duquesne in good position. Good pressure again by that interior from Duquesne.
Yeah, Ramp was definitely going to get nailed. In fact, did after he let go of the ball. Flanker up to the right side. Ramp has trouble, looks over, and it hits one of his linemen in the head. I think they're going to...
Yeah, that's got to be a penalty. Because
it hit the his own lineman in the head that time. Obviously, it was not a pass intended for him, but this is going to be a penalty.
He was going for the intentional ground there and hit one of his offensive linemen.
Well, he did have the right uniform on. John Wojciechowski from Duquesne with the pressure.
Let's watch Wojciechowski here. He's going to keep his outside shoulder free as Ramp's trying to get back into the pocket, set up his side attack. Wojciechowski comes from the outside, has got great upfield drive and forces Ramp to throw the ball before he's ready.
He hit Ben Henry in the head. Another Greensburg-Salem player, 6'2", 265-pound junior lineman. That is a loss of down, so it brings up fourth down. They take it from the line of scrimmage. So it's fourth down and about 11 and a half for the Flash, and they're going to have to kick it away. Coach Catuso's got to be awfully happy with the way his defense has reacted here in the first quarter. Matt Chontosky will come in and punt, and back deep once again, Bryan Cornell for Duquesne. And this field position switch here could be big for the Dukes. Cornell back at his own 36-yard line.
Bryan Cornell needs to receive for the Dukes.
Chontosky handles all the kicking. This one's low. Takes off a little bit. Sends Cornell back to his own 33. Nice move from Cornell. He'll look for the corner. Cornell gets by tacklers and was tripped up at the last moment. Out at the 43-yard line, a 47-yard kick as Tim Henry comes in and trips him up. He's gone.
You're right. Tim Henry was able to knife in and catch him by the shoelace and make that tackle in the open field, or they may have been headed for pay dirt.
Let's take a look at the St. Francis defense now. The Red Flash have withstood the pressure from Duquesne so far, but this one gives them a ball in pretty good field position at the 43-yard line. The defensive front, Jason Geshwind and Greg Gurgley are the tackles, North Catholic and Central Cambria, respectively. Aaron Biddle at right defensive end, Rick Roth at left. Kuzminski, Sarisa, and Snyder are the linebackers. They split the backfield. Bryan Staines still in at quarterback. Gives the ball to Green on the cutback. Green looking to go the opposite way, and Green looking for daylight. Green has daylight to the 32-yard line in St. Francis territory, and a big first down, touchdown-saving tackle by Patrick McKenna. So Rob Begonia's down on the field level. Let's go down to Rob as he's got one of the, I think, basketball players down on the field with him. Rob, take it away.
Thanks, Charlie. We found one of the St. Francis basketball stars. Game, Jason Lyon Roberts. How's the basketball team going to be this year?
Well, last year, you know, it was kind of down season for us. We had a lot of expectations, but this year, you know, the team's coming back ready to focus, and I think we're going to do a lot, real good.
Okay, thanks, Jason. The football team going to win today?
I hope so. You know, I love these guys. They keep us in there, so I'm in here supporting them too. So.
Okay, thanks a lot, Jason. Good luck to you this year.
All right, thanks, Rob.
Back up, Charlie.
All right, thank you, Rob. Neely makes that catch. Nice gain on first down to picking up 9 yards, and it'll be a second down one for Duquesne. Good first down scheme there for Duquesne.
Good yardage on first down as they go to the play action pass to Neely. He's going to make a nice catch on the sideline. That play was set up. The long run was a wide tackle trap as Green was able to get up inside. Defensively, St. Francis out of position and a big gainer.
Second, a little more than one for Duquesne. Kind of a free play situation here at the St. Francis 24. The fade down the right side. It'll be caught, taken into the end zone for a touchdown by Joe Rosado. Rosado, a 5'10", 165-pound sophomore from Seton LaSalle High School, and the Dukes are on the board first.
I don't know if we'll get a chance to see this on replay. Just as you said, Charlie, we're going to see this on replay. His reins are going to drop back. He just gets the ball in the air. Nice route by the receiver. He beats the defensive back as St. Francis trying to play a tight bump and run defense from that corner position. Duquesne with an opportunity to waste the play there so they can force that ball. Nice pass play for completion for a touchdown. Coach Catuso told me he had success throwing the ball last year against this defense. He was going to put it in the air today.
Yeah, they made up a lot of ground late in that game last year. I guess not. It was 7-3, so I'm thinking of 2 years ago. But the passing defense is what hurt St. Francis last week, or at least the passing offense of their opponents, and it hurts them today to start things off as Chris Bergman hits the extra point, and it's a 7-0 lead for the Duquesne Dukes. Now let's take a break as we've got St. Francis College Sports Network and the St. Francis Red Flash trailing Duquesne 7-0 in quarter number one.
Of us, the few, the proud. 20 minutes that can change your life. Inside Your Body is a better body. Millions have discovered how good it feels to be toned and alert instead of overweight and sluggish. Discover just how easy it is to obtain your Nordic Track body with Nordic Track, the world's best aerobic exerciser. In as little as 20 minutes a day, you can accomplish your weight loss and fitness goals with Nordic Track.
I was able to take off 57 pounds.
I've lost 10 pounds since I started with my Nordic Track.
Only Nordic Track has a patented flywheel and one-way clutch mechanism to create a smooth, natural exercise motion that burns calories fast, up to 1,100 an hour. And Nordic Track gives results in just 12 weeks. In a recent study, Nordic Track users lost an average of 18 pounds. Plus, they also lowered their blood pressure an average of 12%. You can do it in as little as 20 minutes a day with Nordic Track.
I changed my life in just 20 minutes a day, three times a week with Nordic Track.
Call today for your free video and brochure.
Special financing has been approved for Nissan's factory-authorized Real Deal sales event. Factory credit personnel will be on site. Starts Thursday, Beer School Road across from the old airport.
Stats as they've had excellent field position following the opening kickoff and now the touchdown kickoff.
Sam Canfoli comes wide to the right side. And tight end Bob Rohrbrough now comes out to be a wing on the right. The handoff to Ross, the fullback. And Ross gets across midfield for the first time today. St. Francis crosses over into Duquesne territory. As Fisher makes the tackle, one of the linebackers, pickup of about seven, it'll be second down three.
St. Francis has gone to the option look two times now. They go to the fullback handoff to Ross as he's able to get up inside. I'm sure the quarterback is reading that defensive tackle to see what position he's going to be in. If the tackle closes on the dive, he pulls it, runs the option. If not, he hands off to Ross as he did on that play.
Jarvis Bell wide to the left side for St. Francis, goes in motion. Behind Joe Ramp. Ramp with the fake to Ross, and he's got it on the option. Joe Ramp following a block, gets to the 40-yard line for Duquesne, and it's a first down for the Red Flash inside the 40-yard line.
And Coach Mayock says, if it isn't broke, don't fix it. They go back to the same play that run it the opposite direction. Again, they read the tackle. The tackle squeezes down on the dive man, so Ramp's going to pull the ball, get down the line, attack in the end, run the option, and there's no one there. As he's able to turn the corner and pick up first down yardage.
First and 10 at the Duke's 39-yard line. Rohrbrough, the wing to the right. And a wide out to the right side. Another option play as Ramp takes it. He'll be hit from behind, flying through the air. Middle linebacker Christian Kesey. Bryan Cornell in on the tackle as well. You get your head taken off with that kind of tackle.
It'll be interesting to see what Coach Gattuso does up front because he switched from the four-man even front to start the game to a five-man front. The five-man front is a little more difficult to stop that option game because you have a defensive end that's got a dual responsibility trying to help with the fullback and pick up the quarterback. So there he switched to the four.
Brings the linebacker up.
He's got a variation off the four to stand up in.
Second down, four. Rolling out to the left side, Bryan Pittman off the tail. Pittman will be close to first down yardage. Stopped at the 30-yard line. Had to get just inside the 30. Mike Dittman makes the tackle. One of the defensive tackles for Duquesne. This is going to be very close. And they'll measure for it on the far side. Once again, Coach Bill Forjanik's Red Flash men's soccer team defeated Duquesne 5-0 this past week. Senior midfielder Bill Turner led St. Francis with two assists. The Red Flash received goals from Jason Mole, Jared Deal, Tyler Hawk, Dan Bice, and Mike DeSocio. Forjanik's club opens its 1995 Northeast Conference schedule at home next Sunday. And that is September 17th when the Red Flash hosts the Hawks of Monmouth at the Stoke Soccer Complex at 12:30. Got a soccer game coming up on the St. Francis Sports Network. Lots of things coming up on the St. Francis Sports Network. You folks stay tuned for future details, but basketball, we're really going to get into high gear. Got two more football games for you, some soccer, some volleyball. It's all coming to you from the St. Francis Red Flash Sports Network. Third down and inches for St. Francis. They go with a straight eye, two tight ends, flanker right. Ramp gives to Ross. Ross is going to be wrapped up. I don't know whether he's going to have this. They got mixed up on the handoff. Wojciechowski makes the tackle. Ramp didn't let go of the ball.
The
Of course, you don't know whether he was supposed to or not either.
They go back to that Reed dive on the tackle. Pretty good pinch there as they're able to hold him short of the first down. It's going to bring out fourth down.
Yeah, fourth down and less than a yard. St. Francis will go for it. Coming in now as a receiver position is David Smith. He'll be tight end to the right side. They go once again with the double tights and double flankers. Sean Ross, the lone running back. Ramp will take it himself, and he'll have the first down. Gets about two to the 28-yard line. Matt Fisher makes the tackle for Duquesne. That sets him up at the 28 with a first and 10.
So Duquesne, instead of being in a true five-man set, which we talked about earlier, they're actually in a four set with a variation. They're going to bring one of the linebackers up, put them at the end like a defensive end, play an eagle backside formation where they're going to pinch a man down into the gap and spread the linebacker out over the guard center gap, which gives them a little more mobility and protects them somewhat.
Under 4 minutes left, first quarter, 7-0 Duquesne. Man in motion, and the pitch back to the tailback, Pittman. Pittman, with a nice block from Ross, gets it down across the 25 to the 21-yard line. Bryan Pittman in for Jeff Satoski this week, as Satoski was injured a bit in last week's game. He's had some nagging problems, but Pittman doing a nice job there with the 7-yard gain.
Excellent lead block there by Sean Ross as he's able to seal the inside. He's told to get up through the hole, pick up the first man that shows, seal the inside, and he's able to do that. And the defender was closing, Charlie. Had he not picked up that block, that would have been a short game.
Second down, three. Back to the eye with a receiver left. Ross doesn't get the handoff. He gets the fake, and Ramp gets the pressure. Mike Orsi almost there to take the ball out of Ramp's hands when he got it.
Duquesne playing some games up front now. They're lining up in the gaps, trying to get a surge. And when you stop the option game, you've got to get penetration. And Duquesne's been able to get penetration in the last few times that St. Francis has attempted to run the option. So stop the option game, get penetration by your tackles, by your interior people.
And Duquesne calls timeout with 2 minutes and 58 seconds left in the first quarter. It's third down and about six for the Red Flash when they come back at the 24-yard line. Make it the 23. Reminder, next Saturday's Red Flash Marist football game will be on the St. Francis Sports Network. I'll be here along with Craig Boslow. We'll be calling all the action from the Pine Bowl. If you're in the Altoona area, you'll be able to see the game on Channel 11 Saturday evening at 7. Once again, the following Tuesday, September 19th at 8 o'clock. There'd be snow here if it was December. The game will also be broadcast on the KBL Sports Network in Pittsburgh at 3 o'clock Sunday afternoon and on Channel 9 in Johnstown next Sunday evening at 9 o'clock. So we got it all over the place. If you missed the St. Francis Red Flash on the Red Flash Sports Network, you're not trying very hard.
Big play selection here for St. Francis. They've been able to move the ball, mix the run between the inside and outside game. They showed some option look, picked up the fourth down to get the first down to put themselves in position here with third and six, as Duquesne's going to come out and go into a four-man front again with that variation with the outside backer bringing them up.
Third down, about six. Flash in scoring position. Ramp gives to Ross. Ross hit at the line of scrimmage, but he breaks free. Sean Ross then fumbles the football. It's still loose down at the 7 or 12-yard line, and Duquesne covers. That is tough. Matt Fisher, the linebacker, appears to have come out of the pack with a ball. Sean Ross had first down yardage, was trying to get free to maybe take it into the end zone, and lost control of it.
Just when you see an end zone and think you're going to get there, the trail man defensively is going to punch a ball out. As we watch this on replay, just an inside dive. Ross is going to fight. Now he bounces it to the outside. The defender reaches in, is able to strip the ball. Ross's arm just wasn't long enough to pull that thing in, and Duquesne's going to take over deep in their own territory.
Well, time for the defense to get tough here and keep them down here. Bryan Staines, the quarterback, with the eye in the backfield. Bill Green, the tail. Tim Gribble, the fullback. Green following Gribble. He'll be stopped in the middle by Christian Kuzminski. Little gain on the play out to about the 13 or 14.
priority deep in your own territory is don't turn the ball over, don't put the ball on the ground. So they'll probably stay tackle to tackle to give themselves a little bit of breathing room. And it may be open up on third day with, or third down with limited ball exchange, because you don't want to give up a cheap turnover here, especially after you made a decent defensive stand and were able to get the turnover from St. Francis.
Second down, 9 for the Dukes. St. Francis with 5 men across the front. Defensively, Staines fakes to Green, looks to throw over the middle. He'll run up into the pocket. There was no pocket. Bill Staines sacked by the red flash up front.
And just when I said you're going to go conservative, keep it tackle to tackle, Duquesne crosses me up. Coach Catuzzo, Coach Flynn decide to drop straight back and try to pick up a tight end across the middle. Good defensive pressure there as St. Francis gets the sack, and it's going to bring up third and about 13.
1 minute, 30 seconds left in the first quarter on a running clock. Third down, 13 for the Dukes at the Pine Bowl. I bet you they're glad it's not raining, because I have a feeling that the red paint on this field will just get devilish once it gets wet. Single running back as Staines rolls out to the left. He may pull this one in. No, he'll throw it deep. He's got a man out there. Neely with a great catch at the 48-yard line. Mark Neely reaching out. I don't know if you'd call that a perfectly thrown ball, but Neely certainly made a tremendous catch.
And credit the receiver there. Neely never quit on that. Let's watch this on replay. It's going to be a sprint action towards the left. Drains is going to look downfield. He's got plenty of time. He throws the ball. Neely's going to make a diving grasp. The defender just quit on that play. It puts the outside defensive end from St. Francis in a position where he's either got to commit upfield or stay at home. That time he stays in his pass coverage, gives Raines, the quarterback, extra time to find the receiver, and he throws it downfield for the completion.
First and 10 at their own 49 for Duquesne. Fullback Gribble in motion. The pitch to Green, looking for Gribble's block. Cuts it back a bit, gets across the 50 to the 49-yard line. A second down and 7 coming up. Tell you, a couple of plays in this first quarter have really been huge for St. Francis. The fumble on the previous series, and now that long pass getting Duquesne out of the hole. And the Dukes with a 7-0 lead really in the driver's seat at this point.
Right, just when you thought you had control of the game, considering the field position Duquesne had, they're able to get the big play, nearly make the fine athletic play to bring it in and pick up big yardage.
Could be the last play of the quarter. 8 seconds, clock rolling. Wide out right, flanker left from the eye. If they get it off. Nope, Staines did not get that one off. That'll be the end of the first quarter. The Duquesne Dukes on top. They lead it 7-0 on the St. Francis College Sports Network.
Hi, I'm Marie Pellegrino. The college welcomes you to the following event. On Saturday, September 16th, the band Rocaine will be in concert in the Kennedy Center at 9 p.m. On Monday and Tuesday, September 18th and 19th, S.J. Hartland's play, Summer Shower, will be presented at 8 p.m. in the Boiler House. On Wednesday, September 20th, at 7:30 p.m. in the Kennedy Center, the Hot House Quartet, a Latino dance and jazz ensemble, will be in concert. Hope to see you at St. Francis College.
At halftime, Father Christian Horovac, president of St. Francis College. We will be talking about St. Francis, the life on the campus in Loretto, and future dealings. If you've never been here, take a look at the Stokes Complex with the DeGaulle Arena, and the complex up there with a new swimming pool and all the athletic facilities. Obviously, academically, the school's a very good one. It's a great place to come. You know, it's hard to get people from for the Division I basketball team. It's hard to get people from the big cities to come up to the Pine area, because it's trees and stuff. It's nice. It's second down and 8. Eye in the backfield. Staines with a play fake. Throws short and it's intercepted. Steve Cereza, the linebacker, makes the interception at midfield. And the red flash take it back.
That time Staines sprints to his right. He tries to force the pass. Good defensive pressure there by St. Francis from the interior as they close pretty quickly on Staines. He forces the ball with the interception, and St. Francis gets the ball back.
And you see Cereza on the sideline there with the little gunned up maneuvers. It'll be first and 10 for St. Francis at midfield. They're jamming up on the center is the defense as Ramp with the play fake throws it upfield. It'll be intercepted right back. Up the left side to the 40-yard line and pushed out of bounds by Pittman on the far side. Linebacker Joe Neckerman takes it right back. And the Dukes are on the march at the St. Francis 30-yard line.
So just when you think you get a break, give it back, and Duquesne's in control again. That time, straight drop back pass. Ramp gets plenty of time to throw the ball. He doesn't see the linebacker sitting. Let's watch this on replay.
What's the fake here? It really was not one that you could buy. It's kind of a half-hearted fake.
As he steps up in the pocket, the linebacker drops back into his pass zone. Makes a nice athletic play again and picks it off and gets to the sideline and picks up good yardage.
When Ramp did the play fake there, the back was already by him whenever he was trying to make them think that they was going to hand it off to him. So it was, if the defense is paying attention, they're not buying that. Quarterback is Bryan Staines. Hands the ball to Green going left. Green with a sideline as a little more, shall we say, enthusiasm behind the blocking of the Duquesne Dukes. Set up Green with a nice run down the sideline and another first down for Duquesne.
Duquesne coming off the ball a little more crisply than St. Francis is at this time. They're controlling the line of scrimmage.
And a 7-0 lead for the Dukes. That came at the 7-10 mark of the first quarter. Staines to Rosado for 22 yards. Bergman's extra point. 7-0 Duquesne in their opener. They look like they've had a game under their belt, Buzz. It really have looked pretty sharp.
Playing quite well for their first game of the season.
Rosado goes wide to the right side. Neely on the left will go in motion. That's out of the eye. And Green hit in the backfield. And he'll go down short of the 10-yard line at about the 11. Pick up a 2. We'll call it second down and 8.
That time Colin Snyder is able to get penetration, make the hit in the backfield. He's unable to wrap the arms. And Green stumbles forward for a couple of yards. Creating the second and 8.
Second and 8 for Duquesne. We have 14 minutes left in the second quarter. Neely goes wide to the right side. Rosado off to the left. Bryan Staines from Father Geibel, the quarterback. Gives the ball to the tailback, Green. Bill Green across the 10, gets to the 5, and just inside the 5-yard line. That'll be close to first down yardage. Hollidaysburg's Matt Weaver makes the tackle at free safety. But that one close enough to a first down, and even in college football, Buzz, I think there's a 4-down territory, and they're in it.
That's correct. Third and short, St. Francis needs to buckle down here, going to their goal line set, I'm sure, and try to get a big stop and force Duquesne to make the decision of, well, it looks like we're going to get a timeout here by St. Francis.
That'll be a St. Francis timeout as Tom Morrow had gone in to replace Matt Weaver, and they were going with the extra lineman down at the 5-yard line. So with 13 minutes and 16 seconds left in the first quarter, or second quarter, excuse me, it's a St. Francis timeout. They've each taken one now. Duquesne leads it 7-0. Oh, my goodness. Penn State is having it handed to them, huh? Just don't go away. I have a feeling things could be different as the day goes by. Of course, Joe said they stink. With basketball season right around the corner, you can get in on all the excitement of Red Flash basketball. Head coaches Tom McConnell and Jenny Przyzewicz lead their respective St. Francis men's and women's basketball teams toward Northeast Conference titles. For more information about Red Flash men's and women's basketball season tickets, contact Leona Noel in the St. Francis ticket office at 472-3018. That is area code 814. The Red Flash, the Lady Flash, are going to be opening up our basketball season on St. Francis College Sports Network
women's basketball game against Penn State Monday, November 27th is of particular interest. I know they're going to be playing Pitt as well. That's another one that we'll have on the air. And they go with a power backfield here. Staines keeps, or rather gives to the fullback, coming up through the middle for a gain of about three or four. That's plenty for the first down.
That time Duquesne comes out in the straight, or triple I, backfield, whatever you want to call it. They've got the straight T with men lined up together. Tim Gribble's going to take it in the guard tackle gap, and it's just a good surge by that offensive line as they just push the St. Francis interior backwards, and it's going to be first and goal in a great position to be in if you're Greg Gattuso.
And that's a look that they had not shown elsewhere on the field. So get both of those wing backs running up, the halfbacks at least, and blocking. And Gribble takes it up the middle into the end zone for the touchdown. Duquesne up 13-0.
And again, mistakes costly for St. Francis. They have the fumble, then they get the ball back on an interception, and they give it right back on an interception. Duquesne able to capitalize, pick up their second touchdown as they take the 13-0 lead as they attempt to make it 14 here with the extra point.
Bergman will try the extra point. As Tim Gribble scores the one-yard touchdown, they've done it through the air, they've done it on the ground, and St. Francis really needs to find an answer here, or this one's going to be out of reach soon. Bergman's kick. It's good. And it's 14-0, Duquesne. We are early in the second quarter, and the Red Flash will receive and go after it. You folks watching on Educational Access Channel 11 in Altoona, there's another game next week on the Blair County Sports Network with Bellwood and Bishop Guilfoyle, so be around for that. Well, boys, what do you do? What do you do to get the offense really kicked into gear?
We take a look at the sideline and Coach Pete Mayock, as he's got to make a decision here. Now, we've got to do something defensively. Primarily cut down on the mistakes offensively, keep from giving up the big play. Defensively, you had a pin deep in their own territory. Quarterback is able to get to the corner, throws the completion downfield to Neely, gets them out of trouble, give the ball up. But it still comes down to the mistakes and being opportunistic. Duquesne opportunistic, taking advantage of the turnover or takeaway. St. Francis unable to sustain anything because of the mental errors.
I think you have good athletes making good plays, and that's what it was when Staines was able to connect with Neely on the big pass from the shadow of his own goalpost.
And we talk about what it takes for one of these programs to get over the hump and take it to the next level and become a heavy contender, heavy competitor. It's nice to be able to get that kid that goes to a 1A school or Division II school that's not happy, transfers in. You get one of those kids into the program, it kind of steamrolls, and you pick up other similar recruits.
Yeah.
And then that's what takes your program up to the next level.
Word gets around the neighborhood. Bergman kicks off, flags down. We'll see if they hand it off this time. They do not. And coming up the left side once again is Lesage. Lesage with another good run back to the 41-yard line. All three of his run backs have been 40 or better. But there is a flag down back at the line of the kick.
And I'm sure somebody's special team coach, meaning Duquesne's, is not happy.
Yeah.
When you get licked three consecutive times with the same reverse, the same fake, you got to be wondering who's doing their job and who isn't doing their job. They haven't given up the big touch, but they've given up field position, although St. Francis has not been able to take advantage of it.
Well, the Flash are going to keep the football. And it's a first and 10 at the 41-yard line. Lesage has got to have over 100 yards in returns right now.
He's got to be getting close.
That one came from his own, what, 2 or 3 yard line. He brought it back out to the 41.
And he was a step from taking it to distance.
Sam Campoli goes wide to the right side. They go to the eye, flanker left. Joe Ramp, the quarterback. The delay handoff, Pittman hit in the backfield and dropped before he gets up to the line of scrimmage. And Joe Neckerman steps in front and makes sure nothing happens there.
Hey, Joe Neckerman is a big physical player, and he's been all over the field thus far in the first half. That time he squares his tail back up and just puts him on his back. And St. Francis tries to go with a counter look, trying to get momentum going towards the left, get it back to the right-hand side. But a good close by the linebacker, Neckerman, as he stops him for a minimal gain.
That play was all Seton LaSalle. Neckerman and Ramp from Seton LaSalle. Second down and 10. Slot man to the right. Ramp on the option. Got rid of it. Pittman will take it. Try to get to the corner. He beats a couple of tacklers and gets up the sideline to about the 44. Those are some tough yards as he's trying to get around those folks.
Hey, that's a good effort on Pittman's part to even get to the corner, because Duquesne was in excellent position to stop that option play. And if you notice the difference between the earlier in the first quarter when St. Francis had some success with that dive option offense, Duquesne had no penetration. Now they're getting good penetration by the interior people. They're getting good close by the outside linebackers and corner men, which is making it difficult. St. Francis is going to have to loosen up this defense, because Duquesne playing in the box trying to take away that running game, although now St. Francis in a throwing situation.
Go to three wide receivers, two to the left side, ramped on the roll, stops, throws in the middle of the zone, and that one nearly picked off. Coming in from strong safety Bob Nithman. He went up high for it, but it was overthrown enough that he couldn't quite grab it and pull it in.
And, Charlie, again, receivers are open, just unable to make the connection. The timing's just not there. And that was pretty much doomsday for St. Francis last week, as they got the four INT. That time they go to the short rollout again, the flood route, where they've got actually four receivers in the quarterback's line of vision. He's got to read the strong safety.
When it comes to the music of the 90s, anything goes. Right here, right
now. Music today is everywhere. No need to label it. If it's good, we'll play it.
That's why we got Living in the 90s. 2.5 hours of the coolest songs on two CDs and two cassettes.
Check it out.
There's only one thing left to say about Living in the 90s.
You're unbelievable.
To order, call the number on your screen or send check or money order. Two CDs, $26.99. Two cassettes, $21.99. Rush delivery available. Living in the 90s is not sold in stores.
Make no car payments in September, October, November, or December. No payments till 1996 during Nissan's factory-authorized sales event, Pierce School Road.
Commit one way, and it makes an easy cut for the return man or the receiver. That time, Cal keeps his feet underneath him and makes a nice play.
11 minutes, 21 seconds left second quarter. It's 14-0 Duquesne. The Dukes have the ball. It's really imperative here for the defense to do a job for St. Francis. Neely wide to the right side. Rosado, the slot man right. Wide receiver out to the left. Single setback. And the handoff to Green. Green hit and rolls up across the 25 to the 26. Flag thrown into the middle of the pile.
Which is, for the most part, going to be indicative of a holding foul, because they actually threw it right at the offensive lineman.
Yeah. You don't have to do that. You know, whack that little thing on the helmet that creates an echo. That's a loss of a yard on the play and a second down 11. If they don't take it, they'll take it. Send them back to the 15-yard line, 14-yard line. That's going to be second down and 21. That's a good defensive play there. Yeah. That you can certainly use those when in a long afternoon. It's been a long afternoon to this point for St. Francis.
St. Francis is going to have to start taking some chances defensively. They're going to have to start bringing the linebackers, trying to line up in gaps, trying to make something happen.
Same set with a single back. That is Bill Green. He'll throw it across the middle, and it's caught by Rosado. He gets about 13 yards back, out to about the 27-yard line. But a nice play, and lots of time for Bryan Staines that time to find that receiver.
And the thing that worked or made that play work is Staines had that extra second to wait till the receiver got to the open area. The receiver has multiple choices there when he runs that route. It's probably a choice route. If that linebacker is setting up to the outside, he's got to bring it to the inside. If the linebacker works to the inside, then the receiver has to hook up right there. That time, quarterback Staines able to get that extra second to throw. The receiver gets the open area. Nice pass completion.
Second down, seven. Staines, the short drop this time, had some pressure, and there's a flag down. I'm not sure what this is going to be, but there was some contact out at the spot of the ball when it was coming in. This may be interior line, too. I didn't see the preliminary call. Maybe there hasn't been one yet, but Duquesne is marching back.
That time Duquesne goes to a timing route, there was lack of communication there because Neely, the flanker, thought it was a run the whole way because he was looking to block, and so did some of the interior linemen because they got downfield. So either it was an audible miscommunicated or someone just got the wrong idea in the huddle.
5-yard penalty for illegal receiver. Loss of down, second down and 12 for Duquesne. Neely again comes wide to the right side. St. Francis with a 50 front. Dropping back is Staines, and he'll be hit and dropped off the sack. Roth makes the tackle, but good pressure and untouched pressure from Rick Roth, the defensive end.
And just as we talked about earlier in this series, St. Francis is going to have to take some chances. That time they bring Roth hard. He's able to get in the seam and get to the quarterback because he had receivers open.
That was kind of interesting because Staines just stood there and watched him come. Usually if you have that kind of eye contact, you can make some kind of move to get out of the way. He said, well, I guess I'm going to have to take this one.
That pocket just collapsed right around him.
Third down, 16 for Duquesne. Neely right, Rosado to the left side. As Duquesne comes up, 3-for-3 on third down conversions. Staines throws the screen. Green has blockers. Green has the middle to get across to the 30, the 32. Not enough for the first down. That was scary for a moment as there were two blockers right in front of Bill Green as he brought the ball through the middle. I thought maybe that one might go the whole way. Pat McKenna stuck his head in.
It looked like it was going to be a big one. McKenna was able to slip in behind that offensive line and blockers downfield and make the tackle, or Green would have been off and running.
So fourth down and two. And that'll bring in Bruce Nelson to kick it away. And for St. Francis, Jarvis Bell is back at his own 32-yard line. Good snap, flag down. I think somebody from Duquesne came off the line a little too soon as Bell goes back, circles, fumbled the ball, but picked it back up. He's inside the 20 and is still moving. There's another flag. That'll probably be a clip. Bell is loose. Jarvis Bell. All the way back to the 43, a lot of excitement, but flags down everywhere, and some decisions will need to be made. I think there's one both ways here, Boss.
I know we got a clip back on the return, a late clip that probably would not have made a difference as the Duquesne man had his back turned to the field and the block came. Let's watch this on replay, see if we can't see what happened. Didn't get to see the initial surge. Let's watch.
See the receiver, the the wide man
be coming in right here.
No, actually, that was a clip against St. Francis. I mean, the blocker was taken out of the play.
I don't quite know what they're going to make the call, and it looked like a...
I bet you the official would like to see that again. We can arrange that if you really would like. Fourth and two. Now, they're talking things over with the St. Francis co-captains, Jimbo Cowan, out there.
One thing we definitely see from that previous play, St. Francis has got to get the ball to Jarvis Bell somehow. He's got fine speed and good open field running ability.
We have a motion call against Duquesne. That one is turned down. We have a block below the waist by Duquesne at the 17-yard line. That is going against Duquesne, unless he pointed the wrong way. He did point toward Duquesne, and that is actually what it was. Now, whether or not they're going to maintain that call, I don't know. Now Pete Mayock is asking who did the block below the waist. Because I don't think there was any doubt on the replay who was guilty of the illegal block.
Pete Mayock does not like what he's hearing, so it looks like this is going to go against him. Pete's asking for an explanation of all of the hand signals that were used by the officiating crew.
Let's watch this on replay again. You make the call.
Now you can see.
There's procedure penalty. Let's watch downfield. Let's watch as Bell catches this.
There has been no foul yet. There is the roll.
That's
unless they're saying that that hand on the back was a clip. You know, he did maybe have a hand on it.
But the official signal, let's run this back in slow-mo. The official signals illegal block below the belt, below the waist.
And it's right there. There. And it is a Duquesne player against the St. Francis player. That was Pat McKenna who got rolled. Now they're going to turn them both down, or however we're going to do this, we're going to have another punt, I believe. That would have been the best option in the first place, I think.
Put a tent around that circus. Somebody make a decision here.
One more ring and they're calling Barnum and Bailey.
That's right. I would like to hear the justification for that block below the waist call.
Really? Now, you know, I would imagine if you're an official and you're out there and you're watching a scramble between players, you could lose track of who's supposed to have the ball and who does, who's supposed to clip and who isn't. Now the Duquesne players would like to know what they're supposed to do here. Just kick the ball and let's get on with it.
I think Coach Gattuso is ready to throw a delay game penalty on the officials.
He's got his back to it all, so he's figuring he's not winning this battle no matter what it is. He hasn't even waged a fight yet. 8:14 left second quarter. It's 14-0 Duquesne. Mass confusion has broken out. But I think we're about ready to resume play. When we last left sanity, Bryan Nelson was back to punt. He still is. He's at his 12-yard line. And Jarvis Bell would like to match that run back on the last catch. Bell is back at the 30. Low snap. Could be and is blocked. That'll be St. Francis ball at the 14-yard line. Well, there's a nice exchange. Chad Connors
comes in. That snap just dribbling back to the punter. Throws the whole timing off. St. Francis, I don't even know if they had the block on that time, but they were able to get in a position to make that block. Fine effort there by Chad Connors.
And a good surge there. You know, they may have had that with a good...
Right, they had two or three people in position there to make that block.
Good position for St. Francis if they can take advantage. And it's Sean Ross up the middle for about four to the 10-yard line.
Now, St. Francis has got to convert the turnover into some points if they want to stay in this ball game. This is an important series, as every series is, but this is going to obviously have implication for the rest of the game.
Well, another thing it does is Duquesne answered a turnover earlier with a score. St. Francis has to come back and turn theirs into a score, too. Jarvis Bell, the wide receiver to the right side, out of the eye. Ross again. Ross slipping forward down to about the 7-yard line. It's third down and about two.
This kid was a hard runner in high school, and he got the lost end of product of John Hayes in Bellwood Annis High School. We were able to see him mature from
a junior to senior years. Looked a little bigger in high school, didn't he?
Yeah. In comparison.
Maybe it was the surrounding players. All right, wide to the right side, Sam Campoli. Third down, about a yard and a half for the flash. Joe Ramp. The pitch to Pittman. Pittman looking for blocking. He breaks one tackle. He got close to the five. Now fighting forward. He may have enough for that first down. Tim Jacoby makes the tackle. Let's see where the mark is. It looks like it's right up at the 5-yard line, which will be enough for a St. Francis first down. No official call yet. And surely they're not going to measure that. That's got to be a first down.
It's got to be fourth and inches.
How could it be fourth unless those sticks are absolutely wrong on the far side of the field? It's got the point of the ball right near the 5-yard line, and the point of the stick is up near the 6-yard line. How do you not have a first down here?
Nice angle here as we watch
Rams first down. Unless they want to call it fifth down. I don't know how you did not have a first down on that last play.
At least get a measurement.
I'm not saying we have the best angle in the house here, but that is inside the five-yard line now. Will that count? Yes, it will. It's first down. Again, we thank the St. Francis College Sports Network sponsors today. They are Hostess Steak and Sea House, Stagger Chevrolet, Crescent and Portage, Time Warner Cable of Johnstown, and, of course, St. Francis College. Motion man is Campoli coming behind quarterback Joe Rant. Ramp with the pitch to Pittman. Pittman cuts inside a block, gets to the one. He reached the ball out there, and that's a touchdown. I was looking at that red center of the end zone as the goal line, Buzz, and he reached it out. I'm wondering, what's he doing? He's going to drop the football, but that's a touchdown for St. Francis.
We'll get to see this on replay, I'm sure. Let's watch the lead blocks here coming by Ross and the interior lineman. Good block there by Ross. Also a fine block there by Marciak. The left tackles, he's going to loop out around. Good effort to score.
And the kick from Chontofsky is good. St. Francis back in the ball game. It's 14-7 Duquesne with 5 minutes and 34 seconds left in the second quarter. And it is Bryan Pittman. And when he reached the ball out, I thought, now wait a minute, he's going to drop that thing. And
I think he's already in the end zone at that point.
Yes, he was.
Marciak had a fine block there as he pulled and looped outside and able to pick up the first man that showed. Ross also, good lead blocks. Very important score for St. Francis as they were unable to really keep any momentum offensively. A lot of mistakes, but statistically, I don't think it's going to be that close offensively, but the scoreboard, most important thing, they're within one score, a touchdown of,
yep,
of an extra point taking the lead in this ball game.
And, of course, a stop at another attempt, at least, in this half would be the goal right now. So the Flash will kick it off, and it'll be Bryan Chontofsky. Matt Chontofsky, excuse me, from Bishop McCourt. Matt's a junior. Pretty capable kicker, too. He's had a pretty good career out here. Joe Rosato is back at the five-yard line, along with Bryan Cornell and Andy DeFazio. Chontofsky's kick. Nice end over end. Comes down and Rosato fumbles. Sometimes that adds some incentive for the running back, and he got it up to the 25 to the 26-yard line. See that a lot when there's a fumble on a play where things break down because people leave their lanes. Nothing going that time. DJ Jenkins makes the tackle for St. Francis.
DJ Jenkins was the star for the Red Flash.
That's a first and 10 at the 27-yard line for Duquesne. Once again, next week, it's the Red Flash and Marist. As we look at the St. Francis sideline, Joe Amp and Pete Mayock. First and 10 at the 27 from the I. They'll split the I. This formation worked pretty well for him in the early part of the game. And the handoff going left, Andy DeFazio. DeFazio will be tripped up and dropped. Before he gets up to the line of scrimmage, Colin Snyder and John Camello in on the tackle. They call it no gain. It'll be second down and 10 for Duquesne.
Colin Snyder doing a nice job defensively there, coming up from his defensive end linebacker position. As Duquesne goes to the belly slant, they're going to bring the backside split back the whole way across, kick out with the onside back, and St. Francis there in position to make the defensive stop and bring up second and 10.
From the 27-yard line, Rosato the wide out right. Neely wide to the left side. Already has one sparkling catch in this game. Off the play fake. Staines running out of room. Throws it short, and it's caught at the 40-yard line. No, they'll say he dropped the ball. Todd Shinar drops the ball at the 40-yard line. Incomplete, and that'll bring up third down 10.
Excellent job by the St. Francis secondary there, taking away the open receivers. Defended just just the way you would like to see your people do it. They're in a zone defense, but they pick up the man in their zone. Duquesne goes to a bootleg towards the St. Francis bench with a lead block by the onside guard. Buys the quarterback a little more time. He had plenty of time to throw there, but no one opened. The last minute, he tries to fire one in nice and low so it doesn't get intercepted or unable to connect, but good defensive play there by the Red Flash.
Third down, 10. Wide out right is Neely. Rosado in the slot. Flanker out to the left side. The single setback is Andy DeFazio. Staines looks over to the right hash and finds his man Rosado very close to first down yardage. He'll put the ball down for a first down, but I'm not sure he's going to get that spot. Dom Patty from Bishop Guilfoyle makes that tackle. That's going to be right on the nose, I believe, and they will have to measure this one. That's a tough pass and a tough catch by Rosado.
Staines has shown some good things this afternoon. He's been able to stay in that pocket and wait till the receiver gets open. That's a similar play that they ran earlier for a first down. Let's watch this on replay. Let's watch Rosado. There's Staines. He's going to step up in the pocket. Rosado goes down low as Dom Taddy is squeezing. He's in good position defensively. But that's a nice pass completion. They're going to call it a first down as Rosado just getting enough yardage to pick up the first down.
It's really about all the only location they could safely throw the football to, and Staines put it right where he had to. So it's a first and 10 from their own 37 for Duquesne. Duke's first game of the season here today. St. Francis 0-1 following a tough loss to Gannon College last week. Receivers either way from the eye. And that's Andy DeFazio again for a couple up the middle. DeFazio gets close to the 40.
As Duquesne goes back to that lead dive as they're shifting personnel now. DeFazio, and they bring Green back into the ballgame, who's had a pretty nice chunk of yardage here in the first half from his tailback position.
Gain of 3, second down 7 coming up for Duquesne. Shuffling a lot of players in and out, and really a lot of weapons for Bryan Staines to choose from.
He hasn't gone to Neely. Let's see if he looks for him, as he's got good speed, good athleticism on that split end side.
And the receiver to the right side is John Hartz, another Greensburg Central Catholic player. Crawling across the middle, it'll be intercepted. This could be 6. Down the right sideline. It's a touchdown for St. Francis. Patrick McKenna, the strong safety.
And just when I said, when's he going to look for Neely, whether the defensive back heard me say that or not, but Neely runs what we call a shallow cross as he's coming from his split-end positions. We'll get this on replay. Let's watch this on replay. Let's watch Neely come from the outside. Staines is going to drop back. He's looking for Neely. Neely never gets in position to make the reception. And Patrick McKenna steps in front, closes real nicely, picks it off, and has nothing but end zone to get to, and he's able to score the touchdown. So now that turnover takeaway is changing. The St. Francis able to capitalize 2 times now.
Chontovsky's kick is good, and it's tied at 14. We got a burner now. Looked early like Duquesne was going to take this one and run away with it. And we're back into a pretty good game situation here for the Red Flash. It's nice when you don't have to even bring the offense out in the field to score. How long was that run back? Anybody's guess is as good as mine, but I think we're looking at about 40, 33 yards. All right. We'll make it 33 yards then. It's a great game, and we're happy to be bringing it to you on the St. Francis College Sports Network.
And one thing that you don't often realize or see when you're watching a game is that time Coach Gattuso went after, not Neely on that play, but he went after one of his other receivers, Rosado, because Rosado's pass route was supposed to clear the defender McKenna out of the play, but instead of running his route downfield, he actually got into the wrong zone, which brought McKenna into the play and was able to step in front and pick off the pass. So those are the small things that maybe you do work out the first week or the first game. Costly mistake, though. You've got to have good spacing by your receivers in order to open up or spread that defense out. That time, Rosada brought his man right into the zone, and he's able to step in front of Neely and go for the touchdown. Nice play there by Patrick McKenna.
And we've readjusted that yardage to 42. Shantovsky's kick high and end over end, and Cornell comes under at the 10. Bryan Cornell up the left sideline, breaking tackles across the 30 to the 33. And it is Matt Farbaugh that makes the tackle for St. Francis.
Now that big momentum is on the side of St. Francis, and Duquesne now has their back to the wall as they've gone up 14 points, and now St. Francis able to get back 14, two quick scores. Duquesne has to reestablish a little bit of offense here. We'll see what Coach Gattuso and Coach Flynn decide to do offensively to try to get that momentum back before the half.
Folks, stay tuned at halftime as we'll have Father Christian Orovec on, and a little bit about St. Francis College for those of you who may not be too familiar. Wide right, slot right. The eye. Staines gives the ball to Bill Green. Green hit hard and drops it to 35, excuse me. That's a little more oomph from the defense here. Aaron Biddle makes the tackle, defensive end.
And you talk about momentum and what momentum does for a team. First quarter, Duquesne coming off the ball hard, very crisply. Duquesne, St. Francis coming off very soft and passive. Now with that momentum switch, Duquesne coming off much slower. St. Francis coming off and attacking the ball.
14 all, second and eight. Duquesne ball at their own 35-yard line. Slot right formation. Staines throws it away down the middle. Incomplete and third down eight. That's the first time Staines didn't at least try to get somebody with the ball. Jason Geschwin makes the tackle.
Good pressure there by Geschwin as he's getting upfield and forcing Staines to throw that ball away. Good play by Staines there. Instead of trying to force it to the wide man in the flat, he finds the open area and he throws the ball away.
I meant pressure. You picked that up, didn't you? We're in the second quarter. Not much time left. Third down at about eight with 2 minutes and 4 seconds left in the second quarter. They split the eye and put Green to Gribble's right. Staines is going to go down back at the 25-yard line. Kisminski makes the tackle for St. Francis, and they're calling timeout now because they figure they've got some time to do something with the football.
Good pressure there by Gurgley. And Colin Snyder coming from the outside. Staines trying to buy himself a little more time to find the open receiver. Credit that sack to the secondary because no one was open. And St. Francis is going to try to get in position here to either pick up a field goal or at least try to get a score before the half.
I think the good news there was that on that defensive series, St. Francis was the aggressor. And they made Bryan Staines do things that weren't natural to him in his offense. Going down was not natural. Fourth down and about 18. And back deep to punt. Bruce Nelson, 6'4", 180. I'm surprised he's not at a wideout or something. He's a pretty big kid. Jarvis Bell back at the 35-yard line.
And with this young man deep, anything can happen, as we saw in that last punt exposition, whatever you want to call it, because it was turned out to work for St. Francis.
Well, he had one of those of your favorite plays last week, Buzz. He had the flanker screen over the middle. He had a real nice gainer on that and really showed some great running ability. He is a quick kid and got some good moves. Bell at his own 35 as Nelson is at his own 10 to kick it away. Gets it away this time. Bell in the middle. Makes the first guy miss. Looks for that block to get in the corner. And out of bounds at the 47-yard line. But those are seven very good yards for Jarvis Bell as he used his blocking very well and got all the yardage he could get out of that.
He made the short catch on the reception of the punt and got upfield north and south, and he's able to get out of bounds.
1 minute, 39 seconds left. Clock will roll. Excuse me, it will not roll. We're getting our levels of football mixed up again. First down, 10 at the 48-yard line. Short drop. There's a deflection. right into the line of scrimmage. Joe Ramp looking out on the flat for probably Mike Lesage. And Mark Rayo gets his arm on the ball. St. Francis 0 for 5 on the third down conversions today. No? Oh, okay. Ramp is 0 for 5 throwing the football. Not quite like Joe. I'm sure he's not happy with that at this point. We'll work on third down conversions next play if they don't get one here. Slot left. Ramp with some time. Throws it toward the sideline. There's his first completion of the day. That'll be caught by Elliot Miller. State College High School grad. As Bill Sepich, the cornerback, makes the tackle. Gain of only 3. And it is third down, 7.
St. Francis working on that short passing game now, trying to work the sideline, obviously, to conserve the clock. But it's important now for the quarterback Ramp to get a few completions in to boost his confidence in the second half, because that has stymied here in the first half with that his first completion, and you can't open up that running game if you can't get a good pass mix.
Third down and about 7. Ramp to the right sideline and wide of Mike Lesage. That'll bring up a fourth down, and St. Francis will have to give the ball up with 1 minute and 22 seconds left. Obviously, that's still time, and they've got to be careful. Rob Ragonier down at field level. We'll be talking with Pete Mayock as he makes his way to the makeshift locker rooms. At halftime, they choose not to go back halfway across campus to their locker rooms. Neither team does. They stay right here at the Pine Bowl. It reminds me of some old junior high games back many, many moons ago. Shantofsky gets it away. Cornell will let it go. This one bouncing toward the end zone and will go into the end zone. Good effort on the play by Dom Taddy, trying to keep that one down tight. But it'll go out to the 20-yard line, first and 10 for the Dukes. The Marist Red Foxes next week here at the Pine Bowl. Hope you will make your way up. And, of course, we'll have that on the St. Francis College Sports Network. Sponsored by Haas's Steak and Sea House, Stagger Chevrolet, Crescent and Portage, and Time Warner Cable of Johnstown, and, of course, the folks here at St. Francis College who have made all of this possible. Great effort. First down 10 from their own 20-yard line. Bryan Staines with the eye. And the handoff to the fullback, Gribble. Gribble will get about 3. Maybe 4. Aaron Biddle makes the tackle for the flash. That'll be second down 6 coming up.
And I think you'll notice here, Duquesne, had they had the momentum, they would have been a little more open on that offense as far as trying to work the ball through the air and get it downfield. But they've had a few misfortunes with the interception for the touchdown. They just want to try to keep a hold of the ball here, probably run the clock out, going into half content with a 14-14 tie.
40 seconds left, first half. The split backfield for Bryan Staines. And to give to Green. Cut it back through the middle. Green with some yardage, gets the first down and out to the 35-yard line. Stopped there by Matt Weaver, the free safety. That's a pickup of about 11 yards and a first down for Duquesne.
And now as you pick up the first down, you get your time out because there's a little bit of daylight, and your options improve.
25 seconds left. Matches the play clock. In college, of course, they have the play clocks on the field, and they're 25 seconds. That is from the referee spot for the snap of the football. If you can't get it off in that time, shame on you, and you get a penalty. We'll just leave it at that. Scoring today, 7-10 mark first quarter. This Duquesne's Bryan Staines to Joe Rosato. The extra point from Chris Bergman, 7-0, 22-yard touchdown catch, 7-10 in the first quarter. 12:42 to go in the second quarter. Gribbled a one-yard run for Duquesne. They were up 14-0. St. Francis is answered with a five-yard Pittman run and a 42-yard McKenna interception return for a touchdown. It's 14-all. First and 10 at their own 35-yard line. Single back as Ramp flagged down, throws it over the middle for Neely. He was not looking. He took his eyes off the ball before he had that open running room. Man, he was wide open. He was looking for his angle to the end zone when he dropped it.
And Staines could have had a Pepsi and a bag of nachos. He had that much time in the pocket. But obviously, we see now why he had that much time, because there was the hold penalty. But Neely kicking himself because he had no one within 10 yards of him.
Really.
In his perimeter. That was just a clear route. They sent two people deep. They're going to use Neely, bring him downfield, square him off about 15 yards, bring him straight across. And obviously the key to the success of that pass play is Staines getting enough time to get the ball to him.
Well, he had a lot of time. There's no question about that. But as you said, the hole in the middle of that line may have had something to do with the amount of time he had. Although St. Francis really was not looking to put much pressure on him, it didn't look like. They didn't add anything to their rush. First down and 25 for Duquesne. Staines, the give to DeFazio. DeFazio will get about three or four. Geschwin makes the tackle. That should take care of the first half. Clock at 5 seconds and rolling. And that is the end of the first half with the St. Francis Red Flash and the Duquesne Dukes tied at 14. Rob Ragonia waiting for Pete Mayock down on the field as he will be the last one to leave the sideline and has to be really happy with the effort to get back in this one. This one could have been a whole lot worse. It started out at 14-0. Pete Mayock and Rob Ragonier down at field side. Let's go down to Rob.
Thanks a lot, Charlie. What a second quarter there by the defense, Coach. They got you right back in this.
Yeah, without a doubt, the blocked punt and the interception just made this a whole different ball game for us. Saved our offense's butt.
Tell you what, you made yourself look real good taking that penalty and then coming down and getting that punt block.
Well, the officials cooperated with us a little bit, so it's just one of those things that worked out for us. I could have looked stupid if it had, worked the other way.
Okay, Coach, just one other quick thing. Any maybe small changes in the offense we can look for in the second half?
I think we need to control the ball better. We need to keep our defense off the field. It's getting hot out here, and defense is getting a little worn down. So I think we just got to look to do a little bit of ball control now. Whatever it takes, we got to find a way to hold the ball.
Okay, thanks a lot, Coach. Good luck to you in the second half.
Okay, thank you.
Back up to you, Charlie.
All right, Rob, thank you very much. We've got some halftime materials to go through here. Father Christian Orvec, part of our halftime. A little, shall we call it a tour of St. Francis College coming up. It is 14-14, Duquesne and St. Francis on the St. Francis College Sports Network.
You and the heart in hospitality.
To thank our loyal guests.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You get a free Haas glass when you buy Haas's Your Way entree.
Pick your two favorites.
There's juicy steak, tender chicken filet, or choose from Haas's seafood menu. Entree includes Haas's fresh salad bar. You get it all.
And a free Haas glass.
For just $11.99.
Now that's hospitality.
Thank you.
This should work better. Greg Boslow, your impressions of the first half?
I thought Duquesne did a good job establishing their offense early in the first quarter. St. Francis flat, which we wouldn't expect since they had the one ball game under the belt, but the line of scrimmage was controlled by Duquesne. St. Francis defense picked it up in the second quarter. They were able to get the block punt, able to pick off the pass for the touchdown. So statistically, Duquesne in control, but the scoreboard says we're all tied at 14-14. Both teams making some adjustments. Mental errors, physical mistakes made by Duquesne, correctable. Coach Gattuso will address that. St. Francis, on the other hand, has got to make some adjustments offensively to try to get the ball in the air and establish the pass, because To my recollection, there was only one completion, and that completion a short gainer. You can't run the ball if you can't establish some type of passing game. So both coaches talking to their assistants and trying to establish something here for the second half.
All right, let's go to our halftime programs today on the St. Francis College Sports Network.
Father Christian Orovac, the president here at St. Francis College, and what a fine setting we've got up here. I mean, this is really something people that haven't come up and seen that they really have to.
Absolutely. The Pine Bowl is an ideal spot for football, for college football, and I'm pleased with the kind of crowds we're getting and their enthusiasm.
Mm-hmm. Now, as far as the athletes themselves are concerned, how important are those people? How important was what they do to the college?
I think athletics are very important to the college. Athletics has been an important part of our tradition for many, many years, and it's nice to see the kind of spirit that athletics engenders, not only in the players, but in the entire college community and in the regional communities as well.
So is that something that the student body latches onto, too?
Absolutely. I think it depends on the season, on which team they root for, but I think by and large they really appreciate the efforts of our student athletes.
Tell us a little bit about the faculty and the student body and I guess the life here at St. Francis.
We have an outstanding faculty, in my unbiased opinion, of course. We have a fine mix of older faculty who have been with us, I should say more senior faculty,
right,
who have been with us for many years, and a lot of outstanding new faculty that we've added to our roster over the last few years. They're very qualified, highly respected, credentialed, and we're very pleased to have them. As for the student body, I think we have a nice mix there. Representing many states, but principally from Pennsylvania, and of course where we work, the area is also well represented here. We have approximately 2,000 students total, including graduate students and continuing ed students, an undergraduate population of about 1,200. So it's a nice mix, and I'm very pleased to have them all as an important part of the college community.
I'm sure those faculty members who you were talking about that were senior probably weren't here 150 years ago, but next year there'll be a celebration, will there not?
Absolutely. We're preparing now for the 150th anniversary celebration of the college. It's an opportunity for us to look back with pride on our accomplishments, not only because we've survived for a century and a half, but because we've prospered. We also look toward a bright future as we aim toward the year 2000 and beyond.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an opportunity for us to have not only a college celebration, but an opportunity for the entire region to look at us and see how we've impacted the people in our various communities.
Sure, and there is a future to it, too. That's the best part of it. Tell us a little bit about the new core curriculum here.
Over the last several years, our faculty have worked at developing a good and solid core. Those are the courses that all students take in common, regardless of their major. So we've looked at the skills and the abilities that are going to be required of a well-educated person well into the next century and beyond. And so we've designed our core curriculum to meet those abilities and to help students achieve those skills that are so important for preparation in life, not just for preparation for a career.
Well, if you take a look at the campus here, you look at the De Gaulle Arena, you look at all of the things that have been improved over the recent years, it looks like the future is fantastic for St. Francis.
Absolutely. I'm very confident and hopeful about the future, thanks to the support of so many people out there.
Mm-hmm.
Not only the facilities that are currently existing, but we have plans for renovating those facilities, particularly our residence halls, and we're planning seriously for the construction of a new residence hall that would house about 150 students.
Mm-hmm.
So we hope to have those plans in shape within the next few months, and I hope that the completion of that residence hall will be a fine point to the celebration, our 150th celebration in 97.
Father Orovac, thank you very much for being with us at halftime here. Let's enjoy the second half.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to comment.
All right. We'll have the second half momentarily.
Well. Denny Brower. Show us your bait.
I catch more fish with Bassmaster than anything else. Bassmaster keeps me up on the latest strategies and techniques for finding and catching more fish more often.
Hey, Sean Grigsby, show us your bait.
I wouldn't be caught fishing without Bassmaster magazine. This is where over 500,000 members of the Bass Angler Sportsman Society share their secrets for success.
It's what you know and where you go that counts on the water. As a member of Bass, I depend on the know-how I read in those 10 yearly issues of Bassmaster magazine. But you have to be a member of Bass in order to get it. Hey, you're a member, aren't you?
You're not?
An angler like you ought to be a Bass member. Come on and join us and start packing this in your tackle box.
Call 1-800-BASS 854 now to join Bass. With your $18 paid membership, you'll receive 10 issues a year of Bassmaster magazine, plus this free tackle pack with Berkley's Glitter Power Worm, Pradco's Bomber Flat A, Berkley's Trilene XL line, and a copy of Bass Baits. That's 1-800-BASS 854.
Located in the scenic wooded Allegheny Mountains of central Pennsylvania, St. Francis College of Loretto has stood the test of time. The college, which will soon be celebrating its 150th anniversary, provides higher education to about 2,000 students, including 1,200 undergraduates, offering students a wide range of opportunities for academic achievement, spiritual development, athletic participation, cultural activities, and social interaction. We also offer a well-respected, supportive, and highly qualified faculty and staff. St. Francis College is ideal. The college's own ideal is the Franciscan philosophy of respect for the individual and a sincere commitment to offer to each of our students the best possible education and personal preparation for the 21st century. Various renovations to the Maurice Stokes Athletic Center and John F. Kennedy Student Center testify to the ever-growing, ever-changing nature of the college. The college offers over 25 majors in a variety of areas, including the health sciences, business, education, natural and applied sciences, social sciences, and the humanities. The core curriculum, which is part of the broader general education program at St. Francis, provides a common link among all the majors at the college. The result is an educational experience that is diverse and practical, and at the same time, integrated and focused. St. Francis College is steeped in tradition and excellence, perpetually changing and adapting to meet the needs of our students, those here today, and those to come tomorrow. As president of St. Francis College, I'm proud to be part of this special place, and I'd welcome your visit.
When I got rid of my gray hair, I wanted a natural look, so I didn't take any chances. I used the sure thing for a natural look called Just for Men.
Apply Just for Men, and in 5 minutes, rinse. It's specially timed to blend away gray, bring back your natural look, and condition hair.
It's a sure thing.
Just for Men, the sure thing for a natural look. And now try Just for Men Color Gel for the hard-to-color hair of mustaches and beards. Brush in, rinse out, just 5 minutes.
Now, a few words from Archie Bunker on evolution.
We didn't crawl out from under no rocks. We didn't have no tails. We didn't come from monkeys, you atheistic pinko meathead.
Archie Bunker on gun control.
Did you know that 65% of the people murdered in the last 10 years were killed by handguns?
Would it make you feel any better, little girl, if they was pushed out of windows?
And now Archie Bunker. Bunker on video cassette with All in the Family, the collector's edition. The Emmy-winning sitcom that broke all the rules. Yours for only $4.95 plus shipping and handling for your first four-episode video cassette. Now you can experience the legendary wisdom of America's foremost expert on everything. Archie Bunker on politics.
Salvatore, Feldman, O'Reilly, Nelson. It's an Italian, a Jew, an Irishman, and a regular American. What I call a balanced ticket.
You'll even hear from Archie on the job.
To get your first four-episode video for only $4.95, have your credit card ready and call toll-free 1-800-445-0909.
Second half about ready to start. We got Matt Shontofsky out at the 40-yard or 35-yard line to kick this one downfield. Three deep receivers for the Duquesne Dukes. Second half underway as Rosado brings it up the left hash marks, heads for the sideline, tries to go corner, and boy, I think there might have been a face mask at the end of that play that went unnoticed. Of course, I could see it from here, but they couldn't see it from down there. You know how that is.
Pretty good job by Chad Connors there, who blocked the punt earlier in the first half, and Dom Taddy as they force Rosado out of bounds at the 30-yard line where Duquesne will start as they did in the first half. We'll see what type of adjustments that Coach Gattuso has made for his team offensively as they were able to move the ball pretty effectively.
Yeah, they did.
Although the score remains tied 14.
First and 10 at their own 29-yard line for the Dukes. Offset backfield. Staines looking to the right. Throws it over the head and out of bounds of Tim Gribble. Tim Gribble, a Brownsville product. 5'11", 215-pound senior. It complete. It is second down and 10. Let's take a look at the statistics from the first half. And you can see the imbalance in favor of Duquesne. But that doesn't mean a thing.
As the comparison, you see the two turnovers apiece, both costly for both teams as both resulted in scores, and that's where we stand at 14.
So it's second and 10 at their own 29-yard line for the Dukes. Bryan Staines, the quarterback. He's got Neely wide to the right side. Play fake, throws for Neely over the middle, and Neely will have it at the 41-yard line. Gets tripped up there. McKenna makes the tackle, but not before a first down from Neely. And Neely really got tripped up. He's getting up slowly.
You go back to the straight drop back. They're going to work that middle zone as, again, Staines has that vision. He's looking downfield. He's got essentially three receivers that he can see in his line of vision. He's got to read the strong safeties and the linebacker to determine where the open zone is, and he finds Neely on that crossing route for the first down.
I'm sure Coach Gattuso's halftime included words like, you haven't given up the lead yet.
Right.
So you get the ball, you should take it back. Staines again, this time to Green. Bill Green gets a few up the right side. Greg Gurgley makes the tackle, but a good surge and really tough running from Bill Green. A gain of about 6 yards, 5 yards on the play. It'll be second down five.
And you look at the difference between the last couple of series in the first half with the intensity and the amount of fire on the our defensive line from St. Francis to where it is right now. And Duquesne's starting to build up that momentum that they established in the first quarter. They've got St. Francis back up on their heels.
Second down five. Mark Mons, the receiver to the right side. Rosado wide left. Split backfield. Bryan Staines, the quarterback. To give to Green again. Good block by the other back. But Green pulled down as he gets to midfield. Christian Kuzminski makes the tackle after only a 2-yard pickup. But the black laid the block out, Buzz. It just closed very quickly.
Right. Kuzminski is able to close pretty quickly laterally as he's going to knife in behind the other lead blocker, make the tackle to hold him to a short gain. Now it's going to bring up third and a couple at midfield.
Third down about 2.5. Remember, next week, St. Francis takes on Marist up here at the Pine Bowl. Come to the game, and then on your respective cable system, you'll be able to watch the game on television. Craig Boslow and I will be here for our second of three. The outlet pass to Bill Green, and Green will have the first down as he gets short of the 45-yard line to the 46. And that's enough for a Duquesne first down, a pickup of about 3.5 yards.
Nice play call there as they clear the right side with the wide people, and they're going to look to swing the tailback Green out of the backfield, and he's able to get upfield, just pick up enough yardage for the first down as the linebacker is responsible for Green in the coverage. He's able to get there, but a second too late as Green picks up the first down.
Well, a flash with a big fight in the second quarter to get back in this game, tie it at 14. Now back it up a little bit. First and 10 at their 46-yard line for Duquesne. Wide and slot left. Green going left, looking for a cutback hole, and there was nothing. Good pursuit from the St. Francis defense, including Rick Roth, defensive end. And getting off the bottom of the pile, that is Jason Geschwin.
Well, defense that time, Charlie, as St. Francis now has settled into that five-man front with the two inside linebackers and the four deep, so they're getting good penetration there by the tackle and a good close by the end. Duquesne goes with what we call the counter geo. They're going to pull the onside guard and the backside guard to try to get him out to give Green some blocking downfield. But that time, well defended by St. Francis as they go to their four set in a passing situation.
Second down, 10. Staines with watch the time. Fires short upfield. Good coverage on the play by St. Francis's Pat McKenna. Covering McNeely on the play. Neely on the play. Neely has really been the main target, and of course he's shown some great athletic ability to some of the things that he's been able to do this afternoon. But that brings up third and 10.
And I'm sure that was talked about at halftime, because in the first quarter they went to Neely a few times. I know he had a couple of long catches for good yardage. Then they stayed away from him, and they tried to come back to him in the middle of that second quarter, and that's the play that was intercepted and returned for the touchdown. So they're going back to what was successful for him in the first quarter.
Tim Gribble, the fullback, moves over. Staines in the pocket. First down catch on the far sideline by Joe Rosato. A well-run pattern by Rosato. Just gets enough for the first down. And that'll move the sticks up to the 35-yard line.
Staines that time shows excellent arm strength as he positions himself in the pocket. Rosato's going to run the out pattern. He drives the corner off, makes his break towards the sideline. He kind of benches right there in position. Staines throws the ball to the outside where it can't be intercepted. Just enough yardage for the first down, so that's a well-executed pass play.
It's a really patient drive from the Dukes. Wide and slot right. Tight end on the left side of the line, and the handoff to Gribble, the fullback. Gribble gets across the 30 and down to about the 28-yard line. Cereza makes the tackle. Inside linebacker for St. Francis. But a pickup on the play of about 7 yards. That's a very nice run and the quick opener.
Right, if you think about what Coach Mayock said at the end of the first half, Charlie, he said he needed to keep his defense off the field because they were on the field the majority of the first half. And this isn't the way you want to start the second half, because Duquesne's putting together a good ball control drive, eating up a lot of clock and really fatiguing that defense on a hot afternoon.
Second down and about 3 as Gribble changes directions. That's Green. Green will not get to the corner. Again, good pursuit. Chris Kosminski makes the tackle. St. Francis has proven difficult to get to the edges on in their defense, but the middle's been somewhat vulnerable.
They've been suspect in the middle at times and suspect to the outside, but for the most part, they've been able to settle down and make the play, but they've given up first downs on consecutive third downs here.
Yeah.
And when that happens, that means you're in for a lot of plays. It's like a pitcher striking a man out on the fifth or sixth pitch.
Yep.
So he's still throwing a lot of pitches and getting a strikeout. But this is another big defensive play as it's third and about 2.
Again, they expose Bill Green, the tailback, as Gribble moves off to the left. Green with some room. Good surge from the defense to keep him from getting too much. Patrick McKenna makes the tackle. Short of first down yardage, but it'll bring up fourth down and short. And this looks like a go-for-it situation for Duquesne.
Good squeeze on the outside there by Colin Snyder as they try to kick him out, Charlie. And his job is to get upfield, get his shoulders square, pitch down on that lead back so he doesn't create a natural seam. That time he closes enough that the inside people were able to pursue out, make the tackle, and keep Green from getting that first down. So Gattuso is going to throw the dice here and roll the dice and see if he can't pick up a first down on fourth and short.
Fourth down and two. Bryan Staines trying to get him to jump off sides. They didn't do it. There's the outlet pass for Green. Green will be stacked up and stopped short. 30-yard line, no more. St. Francis will take over on downs and a good defensive stop.
Great defensive stop there as the linebackers able to get into to position there. Geschwin gets the read. They go back to the play. Let's watch this on replay. This is the play that Duquesne had gotten the first down on earlier. They're going to clear, throw the swing pass there to Green. He tries to make an inside move. Good upfield surge by the defense. And St. Francis is going to take over on down.
Not only Geschwin, but Gurgley in there, too. And they go to the I formation with the first and 10 at their own 30-yard line. Campoli split wide to the left. Pittman takes it off the right side. He'll get very little up across the 30 to the 32-yard line. Matt Fisher makes the tackle. Good aggressive defense from Duquesne. 8.5 minutes left in quarter number three. We're tied at 14. And the chess ability of these coaches has come into play.
This is the first series for St. Francis in the second half.
Yep.
So Duquesne ate up a valuable clock time, and the defense needs a blow. So St. Francis has got to establish something here offensively to keep that defense off the field.
Second down, 8. Jarvis Bell in motion from right to left. The gift to Sean Ross, and Ross runs right into the tackling right side of the Duquesne line. John Wojciechowski makes the tackle along with some help from his buddies. It was Mike Orsi. And no gain on the play. Third down and about 8.
I'm convinced, Charlie, St. Francis has got to open up offensively. I mean, they tried to go between the tackles here, and now they put themselves in a throwing situation. Duquesne's going to be playing a little looser defensively, probably go into their nickel package. St. Francis has got to throw the ball on first or second down to try to loosen things up here.
Third down, 8. They'll be coming. And Ramp will go down. A weak side blitz from Joe Neckerman, the linebacker, and Ramp was exposed. They came from the blind side that time, Buzz. You don't even know that's coming.
And, Charlie, when you get in a situation where you've got to throw the football, it makes a much easier play for the defense. Now you can take some chances, send some people, and that time Neckerman's able to come in from the backside, puts it back in a situation where he has to make a decision as to who he's going to block. That time he picks the inside man. Neckerman loops around from the outside and is able to get the sack, and St. Francis has to punt the football.
Shantofsky will stand at his own 10 and await the snap as Bryan Cornell is at his own 35. This is a short kick. Cornell will come up and get it on the run at the 45, and he fumbles the football. Let's see who has it. St. Francis players pointing in their direction. They're unraveling the pile. This has to be St. Francis ball if they get to vote on it. It is St. Francis ball. That was Jimbo Cowan, who came out of the pack with a football, one of the co-captains today, and it is St. Francis football. That's a big break for the Flash.
There's that turnover. And now St. Francis has to capitalize on it. Let's see if they don't throw the ball on first down. As a coach, and having done, been a former coach and having done some coaching, you get the ball on a turnover, I like to put the ball in the air right away because that defense is thinking about what has happened, and hopefully you catch him off guard.
They go to the eye with a wide out to the right side. They give to Sean Ross off the left. He'll get it to midfield and be stopped right there. Gain of 3.5 yards. And that'll bring up second down for the Flash. Wojciechowski makes the tackle, defensive end for Duquesne. Boy, those punts, you field them on the run like that. Now, Cornell didn't have any problems catching the football, but it seems like that situation creates so many fumbles on punt recovery.
Either or. It used to create the fumble. It allows you to get the ball on the run and take it the distance for a score, but there's some severe collisions when you're moving at that rate of speed.
Joe Ramp brings him up with the eye. Wide out right is Jarvis Bell. And some movement in the backfield. This one will be stopped before it gets going. Bryan Pittman lifted up a leg. I'm not sure there wasn't movement on the line of scrimmage that Pittman may have seen and bought into.
Which is a new rule this year in college football. If the defender entices the offensive line into jumping, they can call that foul on the defense, but usually when the movement's in the backfield, there's no question about it. They're going to get the flag. And it's going to be second down, but now instead of second and five or six, you got yourself second and 11.
And back at the 45-yard line. Flank to the right side, Sam Campoli, a wing back almost. Campoli's up to the left, excuse me. And that is Sean Ross, who takes it up the middle and gets almost nothing. Neckerman makes the tackle, but very conservative play calling here in the second half. Tied at 14, though.
Granted, you can establish ball control by getting the running game going, but when you stay tackle to tackle, get that three-play punt philosophy, you're not controlling. There's no ground control there at all. You've got to mix that pass in somewhere and try to create something.
Out of the eye, twin receivers right, Bell wide to the left side. Joe Ramp on the delay handoff, and this one's going nowhere as well. Pittman got it in the backfield, was wrapped up at the 45. And that's a loss on the play of about two and a half yards. And brings up a punting situation. Now, I would imagine what Pete Mayock is trying to do here is do the field position game where, you know, you're willing to trade three and outs. But Duquesne's not going three and out. They've been maintaining possession. So this one will put Cornell back at his own 13-yard line to receive the punt from Matt Shontovsky. Shontovsky at his own 31-yard line. Good kick goes away from Bryan Cornell. He'll pick it up on the bounce. Get hit to the 15, and that's where they'll give him the ball at the 14-yard line. And the Dukes get it back, but Taddy came down and gave him a good licking.
Dog Taddy with nice collision there on the punt return. And you hate to perseverate on a point, but St. Francis offensively has just not been able to get that ball moving north and south. You know, they've got three plays punt. You know, try to work tackle to tackle. And against this defensive interior for Duquesne, who I think is a pretty good group of players, meaning linebackers and interior, we don't know what the secondary is like because we haven't seen them challenged.
Yeah. 4 minutes, 14 seconds left. We're in the third quarter, 14 all. Duquesne with a ball. Bryan Staines has gone the whole way at quarterback. Staines with the play fake. Looking upfield, throws into the middle, and Rosado goes down for it. Rolled, couldn't control it, and that'll be second down 10. Good time that time for Staines to pick out a receiver, but really, good defensive coverage from St. Francis. Nobody really got open.
Real good coverage there because, again, Staines had quite a lot of time to throw. He takes a pretty good lick this time as soon as he releases his ball, and he's a little slow getting up. But good job by the St. Francis secondary and linebackers as they're able to take away those combination routes.
Second and 10 at their own 14-yard line. Gribble the fullback, Green the tail. Mark Neely flanks to the right. And Rosado is the wide out left. Staines fakes to the first back, gives to Green. Bill Green across the 20 and out to the 25, the 27-yard line. McKenna makes the tackle for St. Francis, but it is a first down for Duquesne.
And his defense has got to be fatiguing a little bit, Charlie. Because, as we said before, they were on the field an awful lot in that first half. And the cold weather that they had anticipated here in central Pennsylvania has not arrived. And it's pretty hot and humid.
And they haven't done much substituting either. This has been basically first unit. I see Joshua Keg from Bedford is on the unit linebacker now. They go to a four-man front. First down, 10. Gribble takes it across the 30 and out to the 32-yard line. Tim Gribble. For about four, Rick Roth makes the tackle. It'll bring up second and six for Duquesne. And this is just patience versus patience at this point. Somebody waiting for the other guy to blow one.
The only thing is, Duquesne's offense is getting all the work.
Yeah.
And they've been able to move the ball, and they got deep into St. Francis territory early in the third quarter and ended up turning the ball over on downs, but they still have shown some efficiency and effectiveness moving the football.
Second and five, again, they split off the eye. Gribble moves over. Receiver to either side. Staines, the pitch back to Bill Green. Green spinning for first down yardage, up to about the 38-yard line. Looks like it'll be enough.
Well, boss, if the defense is having trouble because they've been on the field so long, then why isn't the offense having trouble because they've been on the field that same amount of time?
It's much easier as an offensive player to initiate contact because you know what the play is, and there's such a variety of things that you do. Every play is not the same. Defensively, you have to take each play pretty much the same way from the interior, from a linebacking position. You've got your certain reads and keys, but there's more of a maximum effort when you don't know what's coming versus offensively, you can conserve a little more energy.
First and 10. A little movement in the backfield. I'm not sure that one was planned. Staines gives it to Green coming right. Green will try to reverse his pattern there and go down. Gurgley makes the tackle, but Green found himself on the wrong side of nowhere and had to go back. It was too late.
He tries to create and ends up losing more yardage. Pretty good job defensively there. St. Francis, give, and they've been able to step up and make the big play when they've needed to.
So it's second down and about 13. Not much time left in the third. 1 minute and 42 seconds. Tied at 14. I don't know. Something's got to give here sooner or later. That's Gribble in motion. Staines looks. Has his man. That's the tight end. Shinar across the 45 into the 46-yard line. That's going to be close, but not enough for a first down. They'll give him almost the 47. McKenna and Cowan, the tackle for St. Francis, but a third and short coming up. And an official's timeout is being called as they're going to try and
Duquesne,
they may do a measurement.
Right, Duquesne.
I'll tell you what, while they're bringing the chains across from the other side of the field, how about we take a break here? It's 14-14 on the St. Francis College Sports Network.
Hi, I'm Maria Pellegrino. The college welcomes you to the following events. On Saturday, September 16th, the band Rocaine will be in concert in the Kennedy Center at 9 p.m. On Monday and Tuesday, September 18th and 19th, F.J. Hartland's play, Summer Shower, will be presented at 8 p.m. in the Boiler House. On Wednesday, September 20th at 7:30 p.m. in the Kennedy Center, the Hot House Quartet, a Latino dance and jazz ensemble, will be in concert. Hope to see you at St. Francis College.
That was over a yard short of the first down. And now I want to go back to the one down at the other end of the field that was clearly a first down, and they made him go for it on fourth.
Without measuring it.
I know. I guess you get a measurement. You don't have to be close. If you want one, you can have one. They do need a yard, though, and it's third down. They just wanted to make sure we got all of our important messages here on the network. We really are appreciative of the support the sponsors have shown in the St. Francis College Sports Network. Those folks are really great people, and we appreciate it. Hofstra, Stagers, Time Warner Cable, and, of course, St. Francis College. Third and one. Big play for the defense. Staines gives the ball to Gribble, and Gribble has enough, I think. He gets it close to the 48, maybe across the 48-yard line. That looks like enough from here. We've been right on most of the calls here on first downs. Maybe we could just start calling them from here, and they wouldn't have to bother.
And the official says that's a no-brainer. We don't need to measure.
No measurement.
We're just
going to
call it a first down.
That is enough. That went over the first down marker by less than they measured for that was shorter than, if you get my drift. But it's a first and 10 at the 48-yard line. I didn't think you would. Should we go through that over and over? 21 seconds left. Clock running in the third quarter, tied at 14. Staines rolling to the right side. Has his man underneath. That's Gribble. He's at the 45. The 40 will put his head down, try to drive forward. Good gang tackling from St. Francis, but not before another first down inside the 40 to the 39-yard line. And that's probably going to be it for the quarter. It is the end of the third quarter with the score once again. St. Francis 14, Duquesne 14, the St. Francis College Sports Network.
13 yards on the pass completion from Staines to Gribble.
You win a hospitality.
thank our loyal guests.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Haas's lunch salad bar is specially priced at just $3.99.
Thank you.
Haas's famous salad bar includes over 100 items. It's fresh, homemade, and delicious. We have all your favorites. Hurry in for Haas's $3.99 lunch salad bar special.
Now that's Haas's salad.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, it is down to 15 minutes. The teams have played standoff football for three quarters. While Duquesne has gotten a lot of numbers, they really haven't done much in the scoring department since early in the second quarter. A tribute to the St. Francis bend not break defense. But it's time for somebody to take the bull by the horns here, you think. Bryan Staines, the quarterback, with the eye. Neely left. Rosado to the right side. A quick drop, and the fade pattern that worked for six earlier. Well, Joe Rosado down the right side was double covered on the play. It went over his head. Good coverage that time. Not letting him go was John Camello on the corner.
Camello does a good job that time forcing Rosado to the inside. As Staines is looking for the deep post, St. Francis changed their defensive coverage there a little bit. They're working between a cover two and a cover three. Cover two, you got your two safeties responsible for half of the field, but you try to funnel the man to the inside, as Carmelo did, and it falls incomplete. It's going to bring up second and long.
Second and 10 at the 39 in St. Francis territory. Four-man front for the flash. They look to blitz, and Green gets by the blitzing linebackers. Gets it across the 35, the 30, to the 28-yard lines. Colin Snyder with a tackle. But the blitz burned St. Francis that time, boss.
That's where you gamble. That time, St. Francis anticipating a pass because of the second and 10. Duquesne goes with a lead draw. They're able to pop one up inside. Green's a tough running back.
Yeah.
A low center of gravity is able to shift and make moves full speed, which is what you want.
Out of Northgate High School, a 5'985-pound senior. First down, 10 at the 28. Bryan Staines has done a good job moving this team today. Green again. Green will be hit again, but boy, a top run to the 25-yard line. That'll be three of the toughest yards he gets today, and Snyder makes the tackle.
Snyder's done a great job this afternoon being in position and making the plays. He looks like he's hurting a little bit, but he's been in on a lot of tackles, and I'm sure, you know, as those tackles mount up, those shoulders start getting sore. And it looks like they're going to substitute for him here and see if they can't take a peek at him and see what's...
Looks like he's holding his arm limp a little bit. Four guys across the front. The eye, the tight end is off to the right side. Play fake this time. Staines steps up, tries to run himself, and gets across the 25 to the 24-yard line. In fact, as quick as he gave up on that play, I'm not so sure he didn't intend to do that right from the very beginning.
That time he ran a combination route between Neely and the tight end. And the tight end actually breaks into the flat and was wide open because the linebacker never gets there to cover him. But sometimes as a quarterback, you know what you want to do. You want to get the deep pass. So he's watching Neely the whole time, and he never sees the tight end in the flat. And then he tries to make something out of the play and get upfield without taking the sack.
Very little gain, third down, and about seven for Duquesne. Big defensive play for St. Francis. Staines has time, throws over the middle and overthrows. It's intercepted. It'll be St. Francis football at the 18-yard line as Matt Weaver from Hollidaysburg comes up with that interception. And the Flash come back with it, but there is a flag down. And by the looks of things, that is in the secondary of St. Francis.
Let's get a look at this on replay if we can. Here comes a replay. Let's watch here. St. Francis, luckily they didn't get the hold call. You won't see it. Weaver just playing center field as he stays back in his free safety position, waits on that ball as it comes right to him. Staines attempting to complete the post route, overthrows the receiver. St. Francis opportunistic. They pick off the pass, and again, Duquesne able to move the football, can't get any points.
And that penalty was turned down. It was against Duquesne, so St. Francis with possession at their own 19-yard line with a first and 10. Ready to go. Early fourth quarter, tied at 14. Ross will go nowhere. He'll lose a yard on the play. And Mike Orsi and John Wojciechowski make the tackle. Put Orsi and Wojciechowski together that time, you know. Little word combination.
Again, St. Francis elects to go back to that inside running game unsuccessfully. It's going to bring up second and about 11.
Well, they haven't shown any willingness to risk the forward pass much this afternoon, so I wouldn't expect with their backs at their own 18-yard line they're going to do much of it. Second down and 11. Ramped on the roll. Down the left sideline. And overthrown into the Duquesne bench on the far side of the field, looking for Elliott Miller. Miller covered well, and
There you've got a throwing down, second and long. They run a two-receiver combination route where they try to get this split end. Bell on a post pattern, and they try to bring the underneath receiver, Elliott Miller, into the flat, get him down the sideline. Duquesne playing a zone defense, and that's a difficult pass to complete against the zone because people are going back in their thirds. Duquesne does a nice job there to defend that.
Third down, 11. Bell wide to the right side. Two receivers off to the left. Lesage in the slot left. Ramped in pressure, will go down. He is hit at the 10-yard line. And that is just good backside pressure. Ramp never saw it coming, and it really, Wojciechowski coming in on the pressure, but Ramp lucky not to have dropped the football.
Right.
See that a lot of times.
Wojciechowski coming hard from the backside, and again, St. Francis in a throwing down. Duquesne able to take some chances, put some people in the gaps and bring them hard. They've been able to make the plays when they've had to.
Matt Shontomsky will have to stand in his own end zone to get rid of this one. And Bryan Cornell is back at midfield. Shontomsky's kick is low. This is returnable. Cornell hit, but got it to the 42-yard line, a 41-yard kick, and a good kick from Shontomsky. As low as that was, those can come back at you pretty quick. Good coverage from the special teams of St. Francis. And once again, we want you folks to consider the St. Francis Sports Network a regular part of your viewing habits, as we will be on throughout the 1995-96 sports season. We look for a soccer game in a couple of weeks. We have men's and women's basketball, volleyball coming up. And next Saturday, we'll be here, Craig and I, with the Monmouth University Red Flash. Marist. I've been mixing those two up all week as Green breaks free. Green may have the lead touchdown. He will trip and fall at the 2-yard line. Coming up from behind and getting him, Patrick McKenna, the strong safety, saved the touchdown, but Duquesne looking to take the lead.
This is just, we'll get this on replay. This is just a toss sweep to the left. You're going to get lead back. Let's watch the replay here. He's going to get a kick out block by the fullback. Gribble, let's watch him here. He has no one to really kick off. He gets a good lead block there. Green's going to get to the sideline. You see the fatigue factor setting in, and he gets tripped up and almost gets into the end zone, but Green is stopped in the 1-yard line on a fine hustle play by McNamara.
This worked for a touchdown before, the straight tee in the backfield, and new quarterback is in as Gribble won't get much. Dave Loya, the quarterback, running the team down here. And that was first and goal at the 3-yard line. It's still second and goal at the 3-yard line. Scoring today, the Red Flash down 2 touchdowns early. Gribble scored from a yard out earlier in the game on this kind of offense with that straight tee in the backfield. Dave Loya at quarterback is a 6'3", 210-pound sophomore from East Allegheny. Loya calls out the signals. Tight formation. Loya on the option. The pitch back for Joe Rosato, and he'll be pushed out of bounds. And McKenna once again with a good play out of safety. knocks him out of bounds short of the end zone.
McKenna having a fine game defensively there as he feather plays that option. Quarterback has got to commit to the end. He's got to make the end, then commit on him or go to the pitch man. That time he allows him to string it out. McKenna makes a fine play as he forces the quarterback, Loya, to make the pitch. And McKenna's able to get to the corner there and make the tackle.
9:49 left in the game. It's 14-all. St. Francis needs to keep Duquesne out of the end zone here. The option, and it'll be a touchdown for the quarterback, Dave Loya. 9 minutes and 44 seconds left in the game. There is at least a lot of time left. But Loya did a good job in the option, finding the opening.
That time he attacks the end, and you could tell he anticipates pitching the ball. We'll see this on replay.
maybe we won't.
Maybe we won't see it on replay. That time they go back to that triple eye or the straight set across the backs. They're going to fake to the lead back. Quarterback, it really turns into essentially a speed option as you've got a lead back and then a trail pitch back. The quarterback, Loy, is going to pull it as he sees a seam, and he turns it up inside, uncontested, and scores a touchdown.
Bob Nithman will hold for Chris Bergman's kick. Trying to make this a 21-14 game. Low snap, but a good kick. And that makes it 21-14. Duquesne with all of the offensive movement here in the second half. Finally, they've got some points to show for it.
And to my knowledge, Charlie, I don't think St. Francis has a first down here in the second half.
No, I don't believe so. It really has been a so conservative an offense, it seems strange even calling it conservative. You know, it's beyond that. This is Bill Green's best rushing game, and that is the 20th consecutive PAT for Berkman. Comes out of the Duquesne Sports Information Department. Bill Green's career-high rushing game.
Now we're going to get to see that touchdown. Let's watch Loya as his vision as he comes down the line. There's the seam. He turns it up inside.
Yeah,
and he goes in uncontested. But he makes a nice play to be a good option quarterback. And you look back at the Oklahoma guys that have been so successful in the past. You've got to have good feet, but you have to have excellent vision. You have to be able to read defensive tackles and defensive end. You have to come straight down the line, attack that end, make someone commit, which he didn't do on the play before. He allowed McKenna to feather that thing out and make the play. This time, he makes the end commit. He sees the seam, and Loy is able to get up inside for a touchdown. And he possibly was only in two or three plays, if I'm not mistaken, and he gets himself a touchdown.
The kick and knuckler, Lesage, takes the handoff again. Lesage has been doing a great job on the kick returns. He'll get up short of the 30-yard line this time. Every one of the other ones was over the 40-yard line. Duquesne did button up on that one a little bit. And for Bill Green, 24 carries today for 165 yards. Well, that's a lot for...
he's worked hard to get that yardage. And with the exception of the last run, his longest play from scrimmage, I think in the first half, was 24, 25 yards.
Yeah.
So he's taking it in chunks.
It is first down 10 for St. Francis at their own 29-yard line, and one would wonder if they're going to open it up here. They really haven't had anything going in the second half. Joe Ramp, the quarterback, and there is some motion on the front. They're going to let this one go, and Ramp throws the fly down the right sideline and overthrows Sam Campoli. But Campoli slowed down on that one, Boz. I'm not sure if he would have made the connection had he kept running, but certainly no chance for that when he slowed down.
One thing we get to see is the strength in Ramp's arm. He's got a nice arm. He just needed to get things clicking here with this passing game. Actually, that play was set up to go to a play action, to go to that short bootleg action. We're going to attempt to set up behind the tackle. We had three or four receivers in the route. Two receivers were open. He tries to throw the long one because he knows he's got a free play.
5 yard offside. First down five for St. Francis.
And that may be the biggest gain from scrimmage in the second half.
In the second half.
5 yard penalty.
I think they had another penalty earlier, so maybe that tied it. Bell wide to the right side from the eye. Ramp with a handoff to Ross. Ross trying to get that first down. Gets about three. Nickerman makes the tackle. And That's a pickup of three. It'll be second down and two for the Red Flash, who came playing a very solid game here today. You don't know much about the defense because they haven't been on the field that much, but certainly the offense is controlled.
I tell you, the tackles and the linebackers have been extremely active because they've been getting the most action. Neckerman has made a lot of outstanding plays. Very active as an inside linebacker.
Second and short two. Tight formation. One wide left. Pittman follows the block, gets to the 40, spins the 45-yard line. Pittman to midfield. He's getting away from tacklers and falling forward at the 43-yard line. Bryan Pittman with a nice run. Flag down back at the St. Francis 46-yard line. Normally, that is a clip, hold, whatever. Block below the waist.
Outstanding effort there by Pittman. That time, St. Francis goes to the toss sweep. We call it the Packer sweep. Call it what you want. The student body right. They get ample people in front of Pittman to lead him downfield. And he's able to put together a fine effort. They're going to call it unsportsmanlike conduct.
Wow.
With an ejection on somebody.
Yeah. I haven't seen anybody leave the field yet.
And it looks like Neckerman, and that's someone that Duquesne can ill afford. Let's watch this on replay and see if we can't pick Neckerman up. 97. Nice cut there. We're going to see the personal foul, the unsportsmanlike conduct there, but outstanding effort there by Pittman as he uses his blockers effectively, stutter steps, allows people to cross in front of him, and they're going to tack 15 on the end of this play.
Big yards.
All of a sudden, St. Francis has got something going.
I think what we saw was that Neckerman wound up when he went to hit somebody trying to get to the loose ball. Rob Burgone, you're down at the sideline. Rob, can you help us out on that?
Not so much on that, Charlie, but I can let you know that Mike LaSalle is going to be out for the rest of the game with a hip pointer. He got hit pretty hard two plays ago, and they say he won't be back.
So Mike LaSage out. He was the one that has done such a good job on the kickoff returns today. So that penalty and an ejection. It looked like Neckerman showed the coach on the far side of the field what he had done. And he's out of there. First and 10, St. Francis at the 28. Sean Ross. He'll be driven forward by the tacklers to about the 26-yard line as Horsey makes the tackle. 8 minutes, 18 seconds left in the game, but a short gain for St. Francis. Now, here's where you would hope that they would have been able to hold off and maybe give up the field goal on that last defensive series. Now they've got to get into the end zone.
And attempt 2 points for the win.
Yeah.
And that's going to create another scenario if it happens. But they've got to get 8 yards here to pick up the first down.
And it's Elliott Miller wide to the left side, Jarvis Bell to the right. The quick drop and the fade pattern for Bell. Bell bumped at the 5-yard line. Incidental contact. And that one thrown out of bounds.
Bryan Cornell with the
that time they go to a fade route to Bell, try to get him the ball. He runs a pretty good route. Actually, the quarterback throws a nice ball there as he throws it over his outside shoulder, so it cannot be intercepted. But it's going to bring up third and long here. And obviously, we're in four down territory behind 7 points.
Sam Campoli wide to the left side from the eye. Tight end on either side of the line. And the pitch back, that's Bryan Pittman. Pittman will get across the 20 to about the 18-yard line. And that's going to be very close to first down yardage. Cornell makes the stop for Duquesne. But they're going to come up, if anything, with fourth and short here. And they may even measure.
They go back to the toss sweep that they ran effectively at midfield, which picked up the first down.
No, there will be no measurement here, apparently. There's been no rhyme or reason for measurements in this game today.
Call it fourth and one.
Yeah, fourth down, and I would say no more than a half a yard to go. Joe Ramp. The pitch back to Pittman, and flags go down, and this one's probably going to be against St. Francis. They went with a long count there, Boz, and perhaps tried to move Duquesne off, but I'm not so sure somebody from St. Francis didn't move in the meantime.
Well, we could get a delay penalty here. I didn't see what the time clock was.
Yeah.
But they try to go back to that same play, the toss sweep. They're going to call the procedure penalty. And now that creates a whole new scenario for you offensively. Instead of fourth and a short one, now you're back fourth and six.
So it'll be fourth and six from the 24-yard line. And only 6 minutes and 49 seconds remain. Duquesne with a 21-14 lead. Duquesne really with a dominating statistical performance. But the game kept close by the St. Francis defense. Out of the eye. Ramp looking to throw on the move. Fires down to the left side, and a good defensive breakup.
Excellent.
That'll be incomplete.
Excellent defensive play.
That's Bob Nithman, who reached over and stopped it. Campoli was down there, but really wasn't open, boss. A well-thrown ball, I thought, but
good closing
play.
Good play, and as we said before, we haven't been able to see that secondary a whole lot because we haven't seen a lot of passes. Let's watch this on replay. Let's watch a closing time here of Nithman. Nice ball. Receiver's got position to make the catch. Nithman's going to go through the back. Makes defensive play. And that's a judgment call on the official's part as far as interference is called. But in my mind, he was going for the ball, and it's a good defensive play.
So relief quarterback Dave Loya stays on the field and hands it to Gribble, the fullback. Gribble gets across the 30 and out to about the 32. It's a nice pickup for Duquesne on first down of about 7 yards. Pat McKenna again with a stop.
And he's been active this afternoon,
yeah.
Charlie. He's been in a lot of plays.
Patrick McKenna in on the stop for the Red Flash. Pat Farabaugh also in.
6 minutes left in the game. Duquesne with a 21-14 lead, so if you can just hold them here, you know you're going to get another shot at it. Holding them has been the problem, though. Neely wide right. Rosado wide left. Split backfield once again. And they give to Green. Green going for the 200-yard mark today. He gets it across the 35-yard line and up for a first down. Kuzminski makes the tackle for St. Francis. But it's first and 10 again. And Duquesne with really a patient offense here in the second half. St. Francis, I suppose you could say, has played a pretty strong defensive game, giving up the small yardages, but haven't been able to stop them small enough.
Exactly right, and I'm sure that'll be the comment after the game. You can't not have your defense on the field that long and expect them to make the plays series in and series out.
Loya gives it to Green. Green looking for the corner. Has a couple. It'll be second and 8. Red Flash moving in to play Marist next week, so you would like to win a couple of those games on your own field. You start out with 3 in a row at home, and the Flash and Danger are going 0-2 right now with Marist coming in next week. And they're all good. You know, these teams are all right out of the same pool of players, so to speak. Mons wide to the left side. Rosado wide to the right. The fake to Green. Loya will keep it himself. Loya will have the first down as he runs out of bounds at the 47-yard line. Dave Loya with the reverse option.
And I know Coach Gattuso is high on this young fella. If I'm not mistaken, he may have transferred from somewhere else, either that or he had some bigger colleges recruiting him who maybe changed their mind at the last minute, stayed away from him. He made his decision to go to Duquesne, and Coach Gattuso is pleased with that decision. But I know he's got a lot of athletic skills. He's got pretty good size. I think he's coming in about 210 pounds, pretty good height as well. But he's done a good job thus far when he's been in the ballgame.
Gribble up the middle. Gribble's a tough kid to break down. Took about 6 Red Flash to bring him down as he crossed the 45 to about the 44-yard line. That'll bring up a second down and very short. And time once again at 4:14, so the Dukes running out the clock and just grabbing little chunks of yardage. Well, not little. I guess 10's big enough.
Now they're starting to rip off bigger chunks.
4 seconds remaining in the game. Penn State 24, Texas Tech 23.
Penn State comes back and leads by 1. With the bookmakers are thinking of this today. Second down and one. Green, first down, 40-yard line. Across it near the 39. Flash need a break here, boss. They really got to take a chance on defense and try and knock somebody's head off and lose the ball.
Right. Defensive coordinator, defensive coaches are telling first man to wrap the ball carrier up, second man in, try to strip the ball, try to create a fumble, or try to create a break. Look for him to start bringing a couple of backers, possibly bring the corners hard from the outside. Trying to create something because you can't play a passive base defense and expect to get the ball back for your offense.
Gribble in motion. Green looking for the corner. Nice block, but Green runs into pressure there as he gets it to the 35-yard line. Scott Durning steps up. Jimbo Cowan there. And it's a 5-yard pickup for second down and five. 3 minutes exactly in the game. The worst part of this is not necessarily that the Flash are not holding them on each individual play, but as time runs out and they get further down the field, no matter what happens, you know, you've got to go the distance, and it's going to be a long distance at this point. Loya, the quarterback from East Allegheny, gives to Gribble. Gribble close to first down yardage, but the fumble, we'll see who gets it. And the way they're getting out, it looks like it's going to be a third down play for Duquesne, so the Dukes have recovered. Lost them a yard, though, so it takes it back to the 31.
Jim Codman does a good job jumping on the loose ball there. Offensive linemen drill that, as well as defensive people. That offensive line for Duquesne has done a pretty good job, because they've been on the field quite some time, too, and they've been trying to root out that defensive interior and have done a pretty fair job.
2 minutes left, third down, and a little more than a yard for the Dukes. Duquesne offensive line controlling things as Green comes out, follows a block, and gets the first down to about the 29-yard line. Sarisa makes the tackle for St. Francis, but that's going to make the comeback awfully tough now with 1 minute and 41 seconds left in the football game. And we'll fire it up again next week, see if the Flash can come out and knock off Marist. They got to be getting a little tired of this.
Right.
You know, coming out and putting in a good effort, but having nothing to show for it in the win column. I think Pete Mayock would tell you that there have been some improvements this week. Certainly, they held on to the football better. Defense made some big plays and came up with some interceptions. Defense scored today. First and 10 at the 29-yard line. Gribble for much more. Inside the 25 to the 23-yard line. And a second and four coming up. Kuzminski makes the tackle for St. Francis, and the Flash will take a timeout. With a minute and 15 seconds left. And with that timeout, let's say we take a break. It is 21-14, Duquesne over St. Francis on the St. Francis College Sports Network.
To thank our loyal guests.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You get a free Haas glass when you buy Haas's Your Way entree.
Pick your two favorites.
There's juicy steak, tender chicken filet, or choose from Haas's seafood menu. Entree includes Haas's fresh salad bar. You get it all.
And a free Haas glass.
For just $11.99.
Now that's hospitality.
Thank you. Thank you.
There you see the Flash defense. Certainly have had a tiring kind of day. Those kids will sleep well tonight, I imagine. At least physically. Mentally, it may be tougher.
Good opportunity for the local viewers, anyhow, to see the caliber or the quality of football being played at small colleges and just the effort that goes into preparing a team for a game like this.
Dave Loya. Rosado going around the left side. Rosado gets to the 16-yard line. First down for Duquesne. And that'll stop the clock, so the Dukes are moving closer. It'll be interesting to see here whether or not Coach Gattuso wants to get more points with a minute 8 left. This has got to be one of the few stadiums in the country where you can throw frisbees just outside the stadium fence. As they're doing that over by the woods. First and 10 at the 15-yard line. And they put the full house back there. Double tight formation. Gribble trying to get outside. We'll get to about the 12 and be pulled down there. It's a gain of about four. Kosminski makes the tackle. And another timeout with a minute left.
Scott Durning coming up pretty fiercely from his safety position and gets a pretty good lick on Rosado there as he's trying to get some extra yards or dribble.
Remember that Bill Green was at 165 yards up to this series. And I don't think he's carried the ball enough here to get that 200 mark, but he's had a fantastic day. It's his best ever in a Duquesne uniform. 183 we've got it for now. That's a lot. As part of the ball control they've used, you know, they threw the ball a good bit today with quarterback Staines throwing 25 passes. But still, it's a control type offense they've gone to. In the first half, I thought they were a little more wide open. Second half, they just went to patience.
I don't think this offense has an abundance of variations or plays off of it, but what they do, they run fundamentally sound.
Yeah.
And they've done a pretty good job getting to their assignments with the take away the block punt and the interception, and they've really controlled this ball game.
Second down, 7. They give to Gribble. Gribble up the middle. He's getting close to the first down marker, but I don't think he's going to get it. He'll come up about a yard shy on third down. Time running down, and another timeout. 46 seconds remain. That'll be the final timeout for St. Francis, I believe. So taking every opportunity to hope something happens, a fumble and a big run back or some kind of break.
And positive things for both coaches today, I'm sure. From the St. Francis side, Pete Mayock's got to be unhappy with the inability to get an established offense. You know, and he was frustrated the first half, no ball control. He kept saying ball control, ball control. Second half, he's unable to get things opened up, but he hangs in the ball game just because of his defense ability to bend and not break. Finally, they wear down, and Duquesne able to capitalize on good, fundamentally sound offensive football where they've been able to statistically rack up some yards, although they haven't put an abundance of points on the board. Coach Gattuso has got to be happy with that, but I'm sure he's also going to be looking at the yards gained to points scored and knows he has something to work on.
Back to the tight formation. Gribble will have the first down to the 5-yard line. And I don't know, will they need to run a play here? Yeah, they got 36 seconds left, and we'll see when they get the ball spotted to run the play clock. Just inside the 5-yard line. And they're going to have to run a play here, but I don't think Coach Gattuso is really that interested in seeing end zone again.
No, he's got his headset off. And he's ready to come over and do the congratulatory handshake.
That's right, and the post-game cigar, right?
Right.
And Loya will take a knee, and time's going to run out. 15 seconds remaining. St. Francis helpless to stop the clock at this point. Another good effort up here at the Pine Bowl today for the Red Flash, but unable to withstand the onrushing Duquesne Dukes, who had a very nice start today's game. And had St. Francis come back and tie him. The Dukes just kept plugging away at it in the second half, and it was that kind of plodding affair where they just kept marching the ball small chunk by small chunk, and they come up with the 21-14 victory for St. Francis. It's back to work, and Marist will be coming in here next week, the Red Foxes. And I know that's not going to be an easy affair either. These teams are all pretty good. One thing that you folks are going to know that this level of football, the hitting's just about the same as it is at other levels of football. You know, there might be a speed differential, maybe a size differential, but